From Screen Junkie Studios in the heart of Los Angeles, this is Screen Junkies Movie Fights. Now your host, Andy Signor.
Hello, Screen Junkies. Welcome to another episode of Movie Fights. I'm so happy because today it's the champ's choice. What does that mean? Well, let me tell you. You guys have been aching for another belt battle, so we're working on doing it. And the first step was Mance versus Rocha, where Mance earned the first seat in a fight of three seats that will take on a battle. The winner of that fight will take on Mr. Merle, who I'm going to next, Dan Merle. For the belt fight, the championship battle.
One-on-one.
So that's what it means. We're going to have, we have these three rounds. The winner of these three rounds go to a fight. Those three players fight. The winner, the one winner of that fight, takes on Dan one-on-one for a championship bout. So that's high stakes.
That's high stakes. That is five fights, maybe six, and a speed round, Andy.
Yes,
that's going to be tough.
It's going to be very tough. So you actually chose these players today for this round. So I thought it'd only be fitting for you to introduce and tell us why. So first up, you know him, the fast-talking, quick-thinking master of speed round, Coy Jandrew. Welcome, Coy.
Thank you, sir.
Dan, set it up. Why did you pick Coy?
I have fought Coy head-to-head. This was a much-requested fight. Coy took me to the limit, to the very end, and I respect him as a competitor. And you notice all three of these faces also. I looked at overall record, I looked at recent performance, and I looked at these are three competitors that have not had a shot at the belt.
That's right.
Yeah. So
there's a few people like Alicia and everybody. They've all had shots.
They've had shots. Yes. I like new blood and Coy. I respect for his speed, his commitment, and his passion, and the fact that he took me to the limit once before. So
I've never seen that belt in person. So there it is. I'm gonna say it's inspiring. I'm not gonna lie to you.
Yes, there
you
go. Hand engraved. And great. Next coming out of the booth and into the spotlight, Mr. JTE. There you are, sir.
I'm ready, Andy.
You're ready. Well, let's hear Dan. Ready. Let's hear why Dan chose you.
Well, JTE, we have had many meetings of the movie minds together. I've been on his podcast. We talk movies here all the time. As far as passion and just real love for movies, JTE is one of the most passionate guys I know. And he is a fierce movie fights competitor. He's been kind of a latecomer to movie fights, but I think every round he's done has been very impressive. So I wanted to see him up against these two gentlemen.
All right. And last but not least, he's been here from the beginning. Shows no signs of stopping. It's Hal Rudnick. Hey, Hal.
Oh, man, it's an honor just to be nominated.
All right. Dan, let's hear why you picked Hal.
Hal has been here since the very beginning. And also, Hal is the comeback kid. Hal, I don't think you'll mind me telling people this.
Like, not at all.
You were like 0-10, or like you had a very hard
time. More like 0-8, but yeah, 0-8.
You had a very hard time winning a movie fight. Yeah. And we talked, and you asked me my advice. And I said, Hal, just be yourself, because I know that Hal has an amazingly deep knowledge of movies.
He does.
He's funny. He's really great at this game as far as like making an argument both funny and making other people's arguments funny, and is very entertaining. So for entertainment and just pure heart and turning the game around, I had to give it to Hal.
How do you feel about that, Hal?
Feel pretty damn good. So good that I showed up here ready to kick ass and chew bubble gum, but I'm all out of bubble gum.
I brought some bubble gum.
I had a shoehorn my catchphrase in somehow.
I brought bubble gum.
Well, you three are fantastic fighters, so this is going to be a lot of fun. I'm sure it's going to go long. I'm warning people in advance. But like before we do that, I should probably explain, because all they're seeing next to Dan is the F word. So yeah, there it is. Let's cut to that. Right, show me that again. There it is. All right, so it's the F you, Joe Star shirt, but everyone's just seeing the F word the whole time.
Sorry.
This was very funny, because that's all we could. The rest of the shirt was hidden. Casey and Connor. We can't see Connor. Yes, they're there.
There we go.
Hey, brother and sister duo, you're here in the fan cam. What a show to be on. Are you guys excited?
Oh, yeah. As soon as we heard which show this was going to be, like when you did your little promo, I texted my brother. I was like, dude, we're getting a good one, so we are pretty darn lucky.
Yeah,
so.
And you guys are coming from Chicago, did I hear? Or Phoenix?
I live in Phoenix. He's on spring break from Minnesota, but we are originally from suburbs of Chicago.
Got it, so all over.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Well, good time to visit. You're here for the show. You're going to have to listen, because I may be coming to you guys to help me decide the winners here. We always got to include you guys in this process.
Yeah, absolutely.
Love it. Well, thank you for the support and being here. Have fun and listen to the arguments. Guys, you know how this works. Dan will be still fact-checking, but he's not going to chime in as much. I'm not going to let him sway this, because that would be unfair.
Smart.
So... It's all about the facts, the passion, the creativity. You guys know how to play this game. I don't need to tell you. So let's do it.
Come on. Let's get nuts.
I want to fight you.
You want to fight?
Let him fight.
Fight! You start this fight, I'll kill you.
I can do this all day.
Round one. This one comes in from Solid ID. And the question, in honor of the legendary Dan Merle Sequest fight and Power Rangers opening this weekend, we wanted to ask, what 90s live-action TV show deserves a movie? And we're going with you, Coy. What are you picking?
Now, this is a story all about how Jaiden's life is about to be turned upside down. So I'd like to take a minute, just sit right there. This is a movie follow-up to The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Wow. In posh Bel-Air, born and raised in the lap of luxuries where he spent most of his days, chilling out, maxing, relaxing all cool. The hardest work he did was some laps in the pool. So as he got older, he was up to no good, started making a little trouble in his neighborhood. But when he sent out some stupid tweets, the whole world went yee, and it was clear he needed a reality check in West Philly. Now the movie is about perspective growing near and what it means to take a long look in the mirror. I think global worldview and that kind of reality check is rare, especially if your whack ass grew up in Bel Air. I think the only thing Hollywood loves more than Will Smith in the 90s is a reboot sequel, and the best 90s show to come back in a movie is Will Smith as a pseudo-Uncle Phil dealing with the ramifications of Jaden not knowing what reality is and dropping him into the heart of West Philadelphia. We're talking Straight Outta Compton meets Splash by way of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. I would pay good money to see Jaden Smith and his insane reality tweets, knowing what the world is, put in the hard streets of West Philadelphia today and have a three-act structure of him overcoming the adversity of having a sheltered life and realizing what the world really is. It would give us, the viewer, a note on what reality is perceived as versus what it can be, and take us on a journey through the mind of Jaden Smith, which we've all wanted to know since The Karate Kid. What happened to that guy? Let's bring him back. Let's redeem Jaden Smith with The Fresh Prince of West Philadelphia.
All right. Some Dr. Seuss on round one. JTE, what's your pick?
I don't need a whole rhyme like that. I'm just going to put the three greatest words ever put together. Walker, Texas Ranger. And I'm going to MacGruber this thing. I feel like that thing is so funny on its own that it has to be a comedy. And I'm putting together two of the best comedic minds, I think, in the past decade, Adam McKay and Will Ferrell. Adam McKay will be directing this film, starring Will Ferrell, with an all-star cast. And it's going to be... Here's what I love about Adam McKay. All his comedies, even back to Anchorman, the other guys, he always has some sort of social message in them, whether it be the banks, whether it be like sexism in the 70s. I think we could take that whole what's going on in Texas, the Trump wall, and we could make a really fun story with Will Ferrell playing the most ridiculous Walker Texas Ranger character we've ever seen. It's just so ripe for comedy that I could just imagine what some of the jokes that could come off. He's famous for kicking through windshields. I could totally see Will Ferrell is about to get run over by a car by a bad guy, and classic Walker Texas Ranger goes to kick him through the windshield, but instead of it working, he's just literally stuck in the windshield. He's like, I shredded my legs. Like, Will Ferrell, that comedy is just perfect for it. I have a whole plot which I'll get into, but that's just the intro.
All right, Hal Rudnick.
My choice is the great 90s one-hour show, Quantum Leap. Dean Stockwell and Scott Bakula, what a combo. Scott Bakula traveling through history. This show, unlike any of the other choices, and unlike any other show, navigated the realms of comedy, social situations, and the times, navigating problems of different eras. So it was a show with gravity, and it was a show that could also be very light. And right now, something like that, where we can go back and explore what made this country amazing. What were the breakthroughs? What were the problems? He did episodes where he went back and explored civil rights, where Scott Bakula, this time traveler, jumped into people's bodies and basically walked a mile in their shoes. And it's a pretty beautiful concept, because he looked in the mirror and saw something that no one could imagine. And it's such a brilliant conceit. And there's actually... They've tried to make it as a movie, but it's impossible. They keep coming to the creators, but it can't ever happen. And it's a pretty funny story. Do you want to hear it real quick? Sure. the creators were a husband and wife team who had a bitter divorce. He went on to great success. She really wanted to make Quantum Leap the movie. People kept coming to them, but to spite his ex-wife, the man will never agree to make their joint property of Quantum Leap into a movie. That's why this amazing piece of television will never be a movie, and that's a shame, but it should be more than any of these choices.
All right, guys, fight it out, and you guys can chime in live, and I forgot to say it, hashtag MovieFightsLive on Twitter, which Dan's policing. Fight it out, guys.
Right off the bat, yours sounds like a great Netflix show. I mean, the question is, what deserves a movie? What about your plot and your synopsis makes me want to see it on a big screen on an IMAX theater with surround sound? It just sounds like a sitcom. It sounds like Fuller House.
Let me piggyback that. It sounds like a terrible Netflix show.
No, Fuller House. It is. Will Smith has tried to come back so many times. He is Mr. 4th of July. He is the movie theater. A redemption story a la Creed, a la these tales of coming back is a movie format. You could stretch that out to longer, but it would get contrived and old. This movie is perfect for an hour and 40 minutes. The 80s and 90s movies where you have the redemption story of a young boy realizing how immature he's been is what this movie's meant to be. It's not meant to be a
one
show.
Problem. One problem. There's no wringing any humor out of those two at this juncture in their career.
Oh, no. Will Smith
I can't
still
imagine.
Has it.
Will Smith Nobody wants to see Jaden and Will Smith on a poster for a movie after After Earth. Nobody
totally
wants to
disagree.
See that.
They want that because they got it so wrong. People are still lobbying. People saw Suicide Squad because of Will Smith, and Will Smith actually made those scenes workable. Will Smith still has it. He just keeps picking the wrong things. Will Smith is still there, and Jaden's tweets are the best viral marketing alone. The
they
entire
didn't see Suicide Squad for Will Smith. They saw it for Jared Leto and Margot Robbie, and then they were really disappointed, and they came away saying,
when you left that movie, you still saw the magic of Will Smith. The scene of Will Smith shooting the gun gave Suicide Squad, whatever it was, a big action summer blockbuster type movie. This is a movie that
not
is a comedy
a
to this day. I want any small comedies back, and this is what that is.
And JTE's has already been made. That's a Netflix show called Eagle Heart, starring Chris Elliott. That's already. Yes.
Does that deserve a big? Yes, that does not deserve.
And we've seen action. Yes. Action Will Ferrell had The Other Guys, which was fun, and I enjoyed it. I'd rather have another Other Guys than him destroying a sanctimonious. Like, people love Walker, Texas Ranger. People in Texas.
I wouldn't go that far. People love it.
Not ironically. There are people that love that show on purpose. You'd be negating your audience.
There are a couple of senior citizens left in the heart. There are a couple of seniors out there who love it. But otherwise, the only thing good about Walker, Texas Ranger is the moment when Haley Joel Osment said, Walker told me I have AIDS.
And thank you, because he will be having a cameo in this film.
That, everyone that would know that moment is not going to want to see it. This is the wrong audience for it.
Haley Joel Osment will be playing the deputy to Walker, Texas Ranger, who gets killed when he's investigating the government working with the cartels, the drug cartels in Mexico, to help build the Trump wall.
I need to briefly point out that I feel like the Quantum Leap show could have a resurgence, but I don't feel like that could be a movie. I feel like Quantum Leap is a good episode. Here's what I feel about both of yours,
especially yours. It's so episodic.
There wouldn't have time.
Thank you for greenlighting my sequels.
I don't think we'll get that far. The budget on the first one isn't going to get made back. We can't pre-plan a sequel. We're not the Marvel movies. Not with Quantum Leap.
And here's what you don't realize. You can go to multiple time periods. He can leap into multiple bodies in one movie. Who says you can't finish?
It's going to feel so overstuffed.
It's also going to feel like a prequel, sequel, reboot at once, so it's not going to feel like it's going anywhere.
If you have a three-character arc that sends him on this journey...
Where is he going now?
Okay, well, first, Scott Bakula has taken the Dean Stockwell role.
Oh, wait, so we're talking about Scott Bakula coming? We have a Will Smith problem, but Scott Bakula's going to sell tickets?
No, Scott Bakula is going to be the second banana to the young body leaper he brings in his place, the star of Get Out, Daniel Kaluuya. Okay? Kaluuya. And he will be the new time jumper, and he'll meet up with... So, the Get Out kid, who's amazing,
we think has more box office pull than Will Smith, who has opened all those movies.
I don't care about box office pull. I care about the best movie here. And this is going to be a Quantum Leap story that goes into one story that's really socially didactic, maybe during...
As opposed to West Philadelphia versus Bel Air, that is the most socially didactic. It's the entire commentary.
But I'm just saying, this has commentary. It's going to have humor. You can have him jump into something that's really a comedy of errors, maybe into politics that mirrors the White House, what's going on right there right now. And then you can have him jump into something that maybe finds love or really explores the heart of this character.
Did you watch Quantum Leap? Like, it's just a fun show where he gets to jump in different bodies. Yeah, there are some serious episodes once in a while.
Yes, there were.
But I don't see a plot with yours. I just see Miranding around in different bodies. I'm like, all right, what do we get now? What do we have here now? I don't see a structure.
There is a structure. We're going to follow this character who needs to maybe redeem his own life and learn about other people. And we see the character grow.
What's he trying to redeem? What happened to him?
You know what? He drove drunk one night and he ended up with blood on his hands.
Oh, this is dark.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. That's
and
dark
he part. Is going to redeem himself.
So it's a comedy with a dark opening featuring a car accident.
You know what?
When characters have the White House, right? We're fitting that in too.
Yes. When a character has to redeem themselves, you know what? They go through a dark period of the soul.
All right. Final thought. We're going around. Tell me why your movie is going to be a better movie than the other two. Coy?
My movie has a beautiful three-act structure featuring a redemption of a character we already know. It's built into the real life. It is meta. It is a social commentary. It has all the social commentaries the Quantum Leap could have with the different disparages of different societies, but it is still built in an audience. Like Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, you say those words and you hear the theme song in your head. This could have the best part of Will Smith doing movies. It could have Will Smith have a theme song again. It would have all of the fun of the 90s and the magic of that Will Smith with the resurgence of Jaden. After Karate Kid, I wanted that. I don't feel like the Walker Texas Ranger audience would see that. That sounds like Casa de Ma Padre or whatever that Will Smith garbage was. And that sounds like an episodic show that I might watch, but it's an episodic feel. This, to me, is the only one of these that is not only a movie, but also has an audience and would be fun, and I want Will Smith back.
JT.
Will Ferrell has opened a film that was an action film successfully in a long time. The last film he did was that Christmassy one, then he had Winter's Tale. They've been horrible. Anything that's not a big action summer vehicle has not worked for Will Smith.
Pursuit of Happiness.
How long ago was that?
He hasn't had
like
a chance.
8 years ago.
This is Pursuit of Happiness with Fresh Prince.
Here's the deal. Will Ferrell is still a legitimate box office star. His last film, Daddy's Home, we did with Mark Wahlberg, was a huge hit. The sequel's already been greenlit. You hook him up with Adam McKay, and you have a story where he's playing Walker Texas Ranger. It's so over the top, it's perfect for Will Ferrell. Not to mention, I have great cast. Haley Joel Osment gets killed because Trump is trying to build a wall with the Mexican cartel. Michael Pena witnesses it, and it basically becomes like a Midnight Run where Will Ferrell has to protect Michael Pena, and my finale ends up at the Walker Texas Ranch. The one place he knows where he could fend off all these bad guys. And who's there? Of course, his father. Chuck Norris as senior. We didn't know this whole time that Walker Texas Ranger was really Walker Texas Ranger Jr. Because Chuck Norris is Walker Texas Ranger. And that's where the big finale is. And again, action. It deserves to be on the big screen. He showed in movies Big Short and especially the other guys, he knows how to do action as well as comedy together and to give you that big budget feel. I just think it's perfect. I think Quantum Leap, it sounds like a mess and it's too episodic.
Hal?
Allow me to state my case one last time. No one wants to see Chuck Norris's spray painted on beard anymore. and this has been made. It's called Eagle Heart.
Never heard of it.
Yes, check it out. It's on Adult Swim, starring Chris Elliott. Funny guy.
Nobody saw Casa de Mi Padre.
Hey guys, are we allowed to talk during someone else's final?
Sorry. You do it a lot.
Oh no, no, no! I zip it. Coy, the tone you described really undermines what's great about The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Fresh Prince of Bel-Air was about fun and spirit and Alfonso Ribeiro's dance, and you're really, it doesn't make any sense in the tone of the original show. This movie, the Quantum Leap film, would start out having jumped into one period. That comes to an end. Scott Bakula and the character doing the leaping, played by Daniel Kay from Get Out, would go into the main thrust of the story, which would be an exploration, probably into something that's socially didactic, because that was what the show was so good at. But then it also retains humor, because there is pathos and humor in many of our stories. And that's one of the great things about the TV show Quantum Leap. And then the story would wrap, and then we'd find ourselves, here we go again, bam, set up for a sequel. So that easily navigates three different stories within one movie.
All right, Dan, for fact-checking. Anything you'd like to add?
Just a couple things to clean up real quick. There was some questioning on Twitter about Quantum Leap. Yes, it did debut in 1989, but because the vast majority of it aired in the 90s, we are counting that as a 90s television show. Will Ferrell's last movie was actually Zoolander 2. Daddy's Home came out in Christmas. Zoolander 2 came out a couple months
he was
after
that. He was not the lead in that.
He was not the lead, but he was.
He wasn't the problem with that movie.
Yeah.
The Pursuit of Happiness came out in 2006, so that actually was 11 years ago.
Oh, jeez.
And looking at Eagle Heart, it's listed as a parody of many television shows. It does say most, notably Walker, Texas Ranger, but also a lot of other ones. A lot of people on Twitter had their own suggestions. Gordon and Jeff at Random Reviewer said Beetleborgs or Bust. Dan Brown at Dan Brown VT suggested Third Rock from the Sun. Kim Hanley, Sliders would be a great pick. Nolan Kalchos thought Boy Meets World, think Boyhood, but as a comedy. Andrew Lee thinks Sister Sister would make for a great one and done movie. And Anthony Hernandez said Saved by the Bell, but the main focus is Zach Morris's time freezing powers.
Yes.
And we also have the poll, which right now is we have it's a fairly close race between one and two. So when we're done, I'll let you know what the people on Twitter said.
All right. Based on those arguments, it was a pretty clear winner for me. I think one of you painted the best picture, and I think other two did get knocked down. Just it really got stuck on tone for me of where it came down to. Who had the right tone of what the movie was for adapting the show into the movie? And I think JTE, you had the best pitch. And I think you're going to get the point. You pointed out that sort of, and I think Coy helped you there, but you pointed out that Quantum Leap was so episodic, it sort of got lost and your pitch got a little confusing when you, especially the amount of stuff you were sort of trying to shoehorn in there. And then with Coy, I think they both got you a little bit too much on it, just the tone of that show is not sort of what that pitch was. And I thought JT did, especially when you dropped the Chuck Norris cameo at the end, I was pretty into it. You get the first point. What did the poll say, Dan?
The poll is pretty close. Let me see if it's tightened up at all. Right now, it is 42% Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, 38% Quantum Leap. Walker, Texas Ranger actually is 20% right now.
Of course.
Yeah, that's usually how it works. The polls,
none of those people watch Walker, Texas Ranger.
The internet doesn't watch Walker, Texas Ranger.
I agreed with you. Just the picture JTE painted, and also I'm a huge Will Ferrell fan, and he named his kids in Talladega Nights Walker and Texas Ranger.
There you go.
So boom. I just kept imagining that, and... That's I don't know, the pull. Tone was perfect. Good so.
Yeah. Sure. All right, I'm glad we agree.
That's
good.
That's a good pull.
Yeah.
I wish I remembered that.
That would have been good. All right, well, fantastic. Good first round. Here we go to round two. The question is, what superhero movie performance that didn't win one deserved an Academy Award? And now we're going to you first, JTE. What's that performance you think should have been Oscar-worthy?
This was a tough question, but I decided to go with Jack Nicholson in Batman 1989. That's right, Tim Burton's Batman. Here's the thing, it's rare that a movie comes out that scale and budget, and you have a star, Michael Keaton, who was pretty big at the time, coming off Beetlejuice and a lot of comedies. Of course, Jack Nicholson was a bigger star, but he just literally took over that movie. And when you think of Batman 1989, the first thing you think of is Jack Nicholson's performance, and it stood up to the test of time. When Heath Ledger was announced as the new Joker, everybody said, there's no way he's going to be as good as Jack. And Heath Ledger killed it. It was so different, but that didn't diminish what Jack Nicholson did in that first Batman film. It's still quotable. You go around, when Prince died, a lot of people watched that clip from him as the Joker. It's one of the most quotable films, I think, of that time. I mean, where does he get those wonderful toys? I mean, Jack literally just, I've never seen an actor, especially of that Oscar caliber, just have so much fun in a role and just literally devour it. And like, he is famous because he actually took back end on that movie. He knew how good it was going to be because he knew how big, you know, Batman could be, and he knew how much fun he was going to have actually getting to play the Joker. So for me, it's kind of like the Jack Sparrow rule to me. When somebody's that good, especially in like a genre film like that, they just deserve a nomination, if not the win.
All right, Hal, which one are you picking?
My choice is also a Batman movie, Batman Returns, and it's Michelle Pfeiffer's Catwoman. Her Selina Kyle is amazing. The way she immerses herself in this role, and if you want to talk about the question is the performance that would win an Academy Award or that deserved an Academy Award, the way she immersed herself and transformed and became manic, crazy, sexy, and then just dominant and a badass villain, she had so many different flavors to her performance. She was painting with all the colors of the rainbow as far as her acting performance. It wasn't one note like so many bad superhero movies. Like, we talk about superhero movies nowadays and like villains in Marvel movies or whatever. It's like, oh man, it was a little one note. It was a little underdeveloped. This was thorough, and she presented just one of the great transformation and origin stories that we've ever seen of a villain in recent times. It's not just one of the great, like female performances. It's one of the great comic book villains, Michelle Pfeiffer's Catwoman.
All right, Coy, what are you picking?
I picked a bold and different choice. I picked a character. We all picked villains in their own right, mm-hmm. but I picked one that plays both the hero and the villain in a sense, and I went with Michael Fassbender in X-Men First Class. I feel like his character, the Academy, overlooked. And the Academy likes historical figures. They like movies that feel rooted in reality, that feel important to a time. And as far as the Academy's concerned, and as far as his character's concerned, he played a villain that you have never understood Magneto better. This is a man who took over the role from Sir Ian McKellen, and he made it his own in such a way that you almost forgot Ian's performance. This is a man who played a guy who survived the Holocaust, who saw his family killed, who experienced the most traumatic thing a man can experience, and you felt every ounce of his rage, you felt every ounce of his pain, you felt every ounce of what he was going through. And not only did you see him channel that, you saw him channel that through his power. You saw a man use his acting to channel everything he had experienced into a literal magnetic wave. When he had that satellite scene in X-Men First Class, you saw a man's experience through his mouth and through his eyes and through his entire being experience 60 years of pain, and I have never seen a performance quite so beautifully empathetic. Like, there was so much to Michael Fassbender's performance in that movie that no villain has had the chance to really have, because I love Heath Ledger's Joker. It's one of the best performances of all time. There was no inherent likability. You kind of feel for Michael Fassbender, and you also know that he will kill humanity. You're a human watching this man that will destroy you, and you understand why. And that is a powerful performance. And the Oscars also love Michael Fassbender, and they tend to keep things rather in-house. So I think Michael Fassbender's Magneto was overlooked for the significance of it being bigger and better than the movie it was in.
All right, fight it out, guys.
I mean, saying that his performance, Michael Fassbender's performance, makes you forget Sir Ian McKellen, that's blasphemous. You should wash your mouth out with soap. Yeah. And he exists at the same time mm-hmm. with someone who one-ups him as that character. Mm-hmm. He's alive at the same time with someone outplayed him in that character. His relationship, having gone, he's evil, but he's gone through the time and he's come to a different Ian McKellen's place. It dwarfs that performance.
See, I see it as him getting to that place. You see the root of where Ian McKellen got, and that is much more interesting. You see how Ian McKellen ended up where he was, and that is a much harder role to play
and
than
you
someone
said
who
he
had the
acted,
introduction.
You said you could see him, like, you could see him move. Yes, he acted, like, moving metal, as Magneto. That does not hold a candle to the transformation where Michelle Pfeiffer walks into an apartment and tears that place up. One of the great scenes in movie history.
I think being angry is a lot easier than feeling pain so
visibly. Oh, it wasn't angry. It was mania.
No, yeah, and I understand that. But, like, and in my opinion, Jack Nicholson just put some makeup on. Jack Nicholson could have played the Joker at a Lakers game. Jack Nicholson was just Jack Nicholson in that movie.
Oh, yeah, I agree.
Oh, like, that was just Jack with makeup on.
Jack Nicholson's performance, like, you could see that same performance on a Saturday night after a Lakers victory at Angelica Houston's house while he was doing coke with Sean Penn and Elliot Gould.
Yeah, that's just Saturday in the 80s for Jack.
I think you guys are basically calling Jack Nicholson a psychopath, which he is not. Yeah, he's a little crazy.
He's a party boy.
First of all, let me talk on Fassbender. I think you're taking a lot of credit away from Bryan Singer, what he did with those first films.
I will take all the credit away from Bryan Singer.
The opening of the first X-Men film at the concentration camp is, like, powerful stuff and really lets you know when you first see Ian McKellen where he's coming from. And I think that thread is throughout the first three films, really. And so when you finally get to Fassbender, he has all that material to build off of.
I only consider there two films, but I think that
the third one's horrible. I get that. But Ian McKellen's such a great actor in all those movies. He rises above even the best.
Agreed. And JTE, I will say that you picked the third best Joker.
What?
Yeah, you're arguing on behalf of the third best Joker. It goes Heath Ledger, Cesar Romero, and then Jack Nicholson.
Okay. You're arguing on behalf of the third. Mark Hamill.
If it wasn't for Mark Hamill's voice acting was
I would say that's
point.
The Joker to me, personally.
But Jack Nicholson is doing a bad Cesar Romero. Cesar Romero out Jack Nicholson.
Jack Nicholson was doing that's a bad insane. Jack Nicholson. I don't think that movie holds up for Jack Nicholson.
The only
at
reason
all.
Michelle no. Pfeiffer is able to give a good Catwoman performance is because Jack Nicholson laid the groundwork with the Joker. Before that, they had the Adam West show, which was a joke. No respectable actor would ever have gone on and done that film. Jack Nicholson, actor of his caliber, to take on that role and say it's okay to do this kind of movie and to absolutely kill it out of the gate like that, it
you're
raised
the bar for
comic
books. You're not giving enough credit to Tim Burton Michelle and Pfeiffer, the world building that he did. 1989's Batman was a revolutionary benchmark in the world of comic book movies, and you're taking all the credit from Tim Burton's vision, which is the reason for the success. His choice. What other director would put the confidence in Keaton to pull that off? But Keaton nailed it.
Do you think Jack Nicholson was being told what to do by Tim Burton? Listen,
no,
I think,
he just did no, what he did. He's been doing for 50 years. Jack Nicholson's not going to listen to Tim Burton.
Exactly, which is why he went there and gave one of the best performances in a comic book movie ever. That Joker still holds up with the best of them.
I think when you go back at it, you'll find that it's a little one note, JTE, and I think you'll find Jack Nicholson doing what have become stereotypical Jack Nicholson isms. As far as a popcorn performance, maybe. But to win an Oscar, Selena Kyle, Catwoman, portrayed by Michelle Pfeiffer, was the most varied. She was this nebbishy woman, this bookish woman, who then all of a sudden becomes this feeling being. The transformation that this woman goes through is not just the greatest performance out of these three, it's one of the great underrated movie performances.
I feel like both of these are shaped by the tone of their film, and I feel like when you watch X-Men First Class, you wonder why X-Men Origins, except for Wolverine happening, X-Men Origins Magneto would have been a more interesting movie, because there's that entire segment that's basically in Glorious Bastards with Michael Fassbender, which was better than Glorious Bastards. That was basically him taking down Nazis, being a more powerful character, and that entire segment of the movie became better than the movie, and it was all in one man's performance and one man's vengeance and one man's pain.
Not saying I wouldn't want to see Magneto go around and like John Wick a bunch of Nazis, but as an Oscar winner,
this
varied performance.
In the movie. These are both Tim Burton roles playing Tim Burton characters in a Tim Burton film.
Wow, you really undervalue Michelle Pfeiffer's performance. If you go and watch the 4-minute apartment scene where she tears up her apartment as she doesn't know what's happening to her. She's frightened, she's manic, and then all of a sudden she feels power.
I don't remember the apartment
control.
Scene. That's not a good sign.
I know. You probably weren't born when the movie came out. I was. Here's the thing. I'm a little bit older than you. But that being said, it is such a knockout performance. And again, it's so varied. She shows varied. This beautiful... Jack Nicholson's in that movie, which is one note. This, she starts as a bookish woman and becomes this powerful sexual creature.
We see a hero become
creature.
A villain. We see a best friend. Xavier and Magneto become best friends, and we see betrayal.
Over the
we
course of how many movies?
One. In First Class, he goes from being their friends to their enemies.
No, you
and
need all that build-up to inform
that. In 2.5 hours.
You need
and
all the build-up to inform
neither of these movies ever got a sequel for a reason. I mean, the sequel had an entirely different cast. This is Michael Keaton.
Joker died! What is he supposed to do?
Joker was going to come back in the fourth, and that's a whole other thing. Yeah. But the Catwoman we got after this was...
Tim Burton didn't want to make any more Batmans after that.
I think Schumacher just took over. I think Tim Burton wanted to do one more. I think with Nicolas Cage, it just didn't happen. But I don't think that those characters could live on their own. I think Michael Fassbender's Magneto is better and could live on their own because that is a stronger performance. That man can lead a film.
No.
All right, let's do final thoughts. JT,
I think when it comes down to time... Yes, because she's great as Catwoman, but I believe she did not look at what Jack Nicholson did in the first Batman. She probably wouldn't have even taken the role. She fully committed because she saw Jack Nicholson fully commit. And to this day, there's still artwork done of the Joker and Heath Ledger. It's always the debate as those two, if you ask me. I'm sorry, the Adam West show, Cesar Romero, I don't even remember that much of him as Joker. If you said Mark Hamill, I'll give you a case for voice work, but Jack Nicholson, what's so great about Heath Ledger and Jack Nicholson, they're so different. That's why they both coexist. I'm not a big fan of Suicide Squad Joker. He can get out of here.
Nobody mentioned that.
I feel like Jack Nicholson, the reason why he deserves the Oscar is because he opened the door for serious actors to play these kind of roles. I don't think either of you guys would even be making these movies if it wasn't for Jack Nicholson literally coming on. He really kind of helped make Batman get made. And I'm telling you, he absolutely owned that role, made it bigger than actual Batman. Everyone talks about him when that movie came out. I remember when that film came out. I was a little kid. Joker was the centerpiece about everybody. When you walked out of that theater, you talked about him. You didn't talk about Batman. You talked about the cool effects. But the biggest takeaway was Jack Nicholson. It's the Jack Sparrow rule. Listen, I loved the first Pirates. He was nominated for Jack Sparrow. Not because he gave a great inspirational performance as far as like emotions and stuff, because he was just the best thing in the movie. He drove that movie. He was the movie. You take Jack Nicholson out of that first 1989 Batman and you put maybe Catwoman there, I don't think it would have worked as well.
Hal, final thoughts?
You're talking about why he took the role and what it meant to it. You're not talking about the performance, JTE. There are great actors that have played, that have been in superhero movies before. What about Gene Hackman's Lex Luthor? Okay, Gene Hackman, who was the star of The French Connection prior. Mm-hmm. You're talking about the role made Michelle Pfeiffer. We're talking about the performance that deserves an mm-hmm. Oscar. That is the question, my friend. And this is a transformative role in the history of superhero movies and female villains on screen. She starts as this bookish woman. She infuses a fearless sexuality and power. It's a fearless performance, what Michelle Pfeiffer did. And it's vulnerable, and she's crazy and out of control. You can see it in her eyes. She goes on a journey as an actor and puts on a damn clinic. And the Michael Fassbender, Michael Fassbender, Nazi killer, that would be, I'd put down money for that movie, but as an Oscar-winning performance, that doesn't have all of the flavors that this performance, this complete journey, exemplifies.
Coy?
I feel as if we talked about quotability and everything else, and that's in the writer, and I think that the reason Nicholson came back up was because of Heath. I think that Nicholson should thank Heath for bringing the Joker back up into the limelight. I feel like the transformation you're talking about and the levels of nuance Michael Fassbender also has, he transformed from a friend to a villain. All of the transformative aspects and all of the vulnerability, all of the things you're discussing, Michael Fassbender had, but better. And it is not a man who is playing off the tone of the film. It is a man who's creating a stronger character than the film. This is a man who created a character that was not written well in the comics all the time. Magneto was always like good guy, bad guy, good guy. He gave a character from the comics more than the comics gave him. He transcended the ability of the writers from 40 years of comics into a character that suddenly made sense. After you saw Fassbender's Magneto, you went back and you understood Magneto better. You didn't understand Catwoman better. It was similar. You certainly didn't understand the Joker better because it was just Jack Nicholson. This man was bigger than the sum of his parts, and the Academy loves historical films, and they love experiencing what Magneto got to experience in the film.
X-Men's
and it
fiction.
Leads his whole thing. And without this character, they wouldn't have carried on from X-Men First Class. The franchise had just suffered through X3 and X-Men Origins with Wolverine. First Class was a last flailing attempt, and because of how strong his performance was, we got Days of Future Past and, thankfully, Logan.
You're putting it all in Fassbender?
All right.
Not that
Dan, any facts you'd like to clean up?
Yes. JT mentioned Nicholson's profit participation mm-hmm. in Batman. This is one of they call it maybe the savviest move in movie history. Mm-hmm. Jack Nicholson took a $4 million pay cut to play the Joker. Instead of $10 million, he took $6 in exchange for profit participation in the franchise. Mm-hmm. He ended up making over $100 million just from that one role, wow. from ancillaries, from merchandising, from the sequels. So
he got enough gold. Give him another one.
Good job, Jack Nicholson. They paid him $96 million more instead of $4 million. Tim Burton, according to Tim Burton, he wanted to do a third Batman film, but Warner Brothers actually kind of sort of subtly discouraged him because there were so many complaints over Batman Returns being too dark. McDonald's in particular was not happy.
Yeah.
I'm serious, was not happy with how dark that movie was.
It didn't do as well as the first one.
Too dark for us.
So he was kind of
amazing
asked,
that McDonald's then
had that
deemed
kind of power.
I know, right? Batman history.
He was asked, not asked, to leave, so Joel Schumacher took over. That's why Batman Forever is so much brighter, is that he promised that it would be brighter. Mm-hmm. A lot of people online have their own ideas. Terrence Stamp is Zod at Fast Day 17. Earl Haley is Rorschach. Mm. Nolan Dean picks Doc Octopus, Alfred Molina. Ryan Reynolds, Mark at Melkovar says, it's hard to think of somebody besides Ryan Reynolds for this question. Billy Paulihan thinks it's Christopher Reeve, Superman. J.K. Simmons says J. Jonah Jameson. Logan Adair says that. And Mac Poole says, wild card, Raul Julia as Gomez Adams, since that is technically based on a comic strip for the Adams Family movies. So a lot of people have their own ideas, and we have a front runner in the poll, which I'll tell you after you give your ruling.
Based on those arguments, I think Hal gets the point.
Wow.
A little stronger on me and showing me the nuance, the multiple flavors, etc. And sort of, I think, put Jack Nicholson to tea by showing it's one note in that it's Jack doing Jack. And I think you did get hung up on sort of, he's a great Joker, but the performance was hung up. And then, yeah, I think they both got Michael Fassbender test, because when you sort of said he's not as good or he's better than Ian McKellen, it sort of did take the argument down for me a bit. Yes, good performance, but I think Hal did a better job painting the picture of what Michelle Pfeiffer did. Dan, what do they say online?
Well, the online poll right now has 45% voting for Michael Fassbender, 35% the Joker, Jack Nicholson, only 19% voting for Michelle Pfeiffer. Mm-hmm. So, once again, the third place finisher in our Twitter poll has won.
That's what I do here. Connor, any thoughts in that round?
I think Hal did the best job taking everybody else down, so I would have given him a point. But Magneto's personally my favorite, and I would have thrown in Brian Cox as a William Stryker in X-Men 2 as a supporting actor.
Yeah, thank you. I agree. I just think Hal did the best arguing there. Whether I agree or not.
Michelle Pfeiffer's great.
It was a great performance.
She was my second choice. I had a really hard time arguing, so I was like, I love her in that.
These are all performances I really enjoy.
You pulled out the Gene Hackman card. You pointed out that was a good punch, too. A lot of good punches. All right. Round three. This one comes in from Soul of One fan. We had to do a Stallone question in honor of JT here, big fan.
Yes.
So we thought we'd finally do this. What is the greatest Stallone performance? Hal, you're starting. What's your performance?
You know what? This film doesn't quite have the bombast of some of his other titles, but the best, most varied Stallone performance, guys, it is First Blood.
First Blood. Let's hear all the titles. Coy, what are you picking?
Creed, his Logan.
Whoa. Okay. And then JC?
His logo is Rocky Balboa. Mine will be Rocky 1976.
Ooh. Rocky. Okay. Going back to Hal. Go ahead.
Wait.
Sorry. What was that on the board?
Oh, no.
Trick question!
I didn't think you were going to do this.
Oh, damn it.
It can come at any time. People think it's predictable. It's so not. It makes the game so much more fun. Oh,
this is
so
like
actually, sorry, wrong question. Let's throw the right question back up.
What is the worst
Stallone performance?
I'm sorry, Stallone, if you ever see this.
So let's go back. We're talking about the worst Stallone performance.
Two for two.
How? Why is First... And I want to remind you, if you tell me your performance is good, you lose.
Mm-hmm.
Hal, why is First Blood Stallone's worst performance?
Because it's too violent, monosyllabic nonsense. This performance in the film First Blood, it absolutely led to this being by far the lowest box office of the three films we saw. You see in the sequel to First Blood, Rambo, complete departure from the dreary, boring tones of Sylvester Stallone in First Blood. He becomes a patriotic, kick-ass action hero in the second one. Who wants a whiny action movie? It is utter garbage. Flush it down the toilet, put it in the trash compactor, and let's forget that this blemish on Sylvester Stallone's career ever took place.
Coy, why is Creed his Stallone's worst performance?
Should've won Oscar for that.
Creed is clearly his worst performance because he didn't even write it. He was disinterested. He decided to take a back seat. He let another man take over his franchise. This was Stallone playing at his weakest. He literally felt like he slept, walked through it. He just showed up on set, looked tired, decided to shoehorn a cancer plot line in order to be on the back burner. The man literally didn't even feel like training his protege. The man showed up on set, pretended to be exhausted because he actually was, because he didn't want to be there. He was running around making Expendables movies. This guy guy had clearly given up by the time he got to Creed to such a level that he didn't even commit to Rocky. He walked. The metaphor for his performance being so bad was slowly walking up those Rocky stairs, defeated, alone, dejected. He had to have another guy carry him up. He literally handed over the powerful performance of Rocky to another man himself. He broke his own heart. This was a man that once sold his own dog to write Rocky, and then he backtracked on that by letting his own franchise go. It was disgusting.
All right, JT, why is Rocky the worst Stallone performance?
All right, let's go for this. I mean, what a hack. This movie was literally just a ripoff. His whole performance was a ripoff of Marlon Brando in On the Waterfront. He's supposed to be like this whole new thing. Oh, it's this great new character he built. It was already done by Marlon Brando, a much better, much talented actor. Look at the filmographies, everybody. I mean, this guy wrote the movie for himself. I mean, that's a little self-indulgent. I don't know what he was thinking doing this. He wrote a slow, dumb guy because he felt like that was where his acting range was. The ceiling wasn't that high. He had to just, it was a lazy performance. And then what did he do? He did what every bad actor does. He surrounds himself by fantastic actors. He gets Tally Shaw out of the Coppola family. He's got Burgess Meredith, Hollywood royalty, who just kills it. Everyone was nominated for the best supporting actor in that movie. Not to mention, he even get enough shape for the movie. When I saw Apollo, he looked in much better shape. He didn't even look, he looked like he was just, you know, pulled out of the street, was never even training to be a boxer. It was a lazy performance from beginning to end, and it's his worst performance. I'll talk more why Creed's his best.
I'll tell you why both your answers are out of whack, because you got a bunch of things on trophy shelves telling you you're wrong. He won a Golden Globe for that performance, and he was nominated for an Oscar. This was an Oscar-winning Best Picture.
Mine
you
is
don't
so
have
bad.
A central
it,
performance
it ended the
bottom
franchise,
out.
Your great franchise started. I'm sorry, it was the worst performance. It didn't even like allow for more. It was so bad it shut down Rocky. It was the worst performance possible. At least Rocky, he gave it his all. He wrote it. He put in the work. I mean, Rambo, he changed what an action star could be. He didn't need dialogue. He was better than dialogue.
Yes, he did. I'm talking about First Blood, my man. I'm talking about First Blood.
To be quiet and that powerful.
A tone-deaf murder fest.
These are both original. These are both original.
A tone-deaf, monosyllabic murder fest.
Mine just went through the tropes. He got cancer. He needed help. He was a coach.
Why was Rambo box office success, and then it led to Rambo 3 other and sequels, but First Blood, not a huge box office movie, and because the tone was off, his
not
performance
true.
Was
foolish.
First Blood
was a big hit. And let me tell you, the reason why he deserves both these movies are some of his best performances. One, his silent performance. It was almost like reminiscent of the great silent actors of old.
Absolutely.
It was just all physical. It was the look, the madness behind his eyes.
It wasn't, you guys haven't seen the movie in a while.
I watched
it
a week ago.
It wasn't silent.
Yeah,
what about
you,
the
TV? He was silent.
I watched it literally a couple weeks ago.
What about the scene where he's like, I'm sick.
Powerful.
Oh, so deep. The layers about the Vietnam War that he had to go with the veterans. And you're he has all these movies. He had this character for so long to build upon and actually create something of his own, whereas mine was just a ripoff of On the Waterfront.
I mean, compared him, he dejected. He got a cancer trope out of boredom. The guy literally just hit all the notes. He's like, oh, I work in an Italian restaurant. I'm Rocky Balboa. Look how famous and hard that is. Look at this new young protege. I've seen The Karate Kid too, guy.
You're talking about stakes. You're talking about stakes, which makes it great for a great performance. Rocky had no stakes in the first movie. He was just a bum on the street.
He was a manager.
Stakes,
I mean,
going up against getting a shot at the world champion is no stakes.
Kind of
those stakes is why it won the Oscar.
He didn't even
fight
in my movie. He lost at the end of Rocky.
He didn't even fight in my movie. There were no stakes in a man not fighting.
Yes, he didn't win, and that's what's beautiful about the movie. You can have a moral victory, and he showed it. He showed his moral victory of humanity.
He just showed he was a sore loser.
By the way, that movie, it's a great transformation.
All
the guy.
Sit and walk. He does some talking. He walks some more. He sits a lot more.
He doesn't
more in the
want part of Adonis. He doesn't want part of Adonis Creed. Adonis Creed wins him over. He's going through personal illness. He acts the crap out of acting, why he won a Golden Globe.
Michael B. Jordan does act around him. I agree. Michael B. Jordan is a powerful performance. Adonis Creed is a titan in that movie that overshadows Stallone in his own role.
And
what a horrible feat that would be.
And you said he was inspired by Brando. How is that a bad thing? How is that a bad thing?
It's a bad thing when
you're not. It doesn't affect his. You're not talking about his performance.
When your first major role,
that's his performance.
He didn't give a great performance. He copied a great performance. There's a big difference.
Oh, that
if you're starting out and you write your own script and have Brando mention the same sentence, that's you did something
right.
That's
a smart move. He's like, I'm a rookie and I need to.
But the question is,
my game. You know, maybe I'll take over one of the greats.
At the end of the day, you hear Eye of the Tiger, you think Rocky.
Yo, I'm not finished yet. I'm not finished. But this movie, First Blood, it's like he watched Deer Hunter and he's like, oh yeah, I can do that. No.
All right, well, can we hear? Can you guys all do performances of your roles?
Yeah, go for it.
Let's hear. All right, First all Blood. Right. Let's hear it. Okay. JT, let's see Rocky.
Yo, Adrian, Mickey, what's my line? Oh, that's my line? Yo, Adrian, you know, sometimes I just want to win, you know what I'm saying? I can't remember my line. What's my line?
That was him. He was an amateur. He was a rookie.
That's better acting than I just did.
Both? Yeah. I wouldn't call what you just did acting.
Yes! Thank you!
But
thank you!
Are you, well, here's a problem.
Thank you!
Are you comparing yourself to Sylvester Stallone, sir?
Hey, I'm just playing by the rules.
Blood?
Hey, I'm just playing by the rules.
First Blood was a silent performance that was all about physicality, and nobody did better
silent.
In that movie than in
it
that film.
Silent.
All right, let's see Coy's. Do you have a performance of Creed?
Adrian died, and dementia, and Mike and Mikey died. Everybody around me died. I feel old and dejected. I think I run restaurant now, and this new guy, without much coercion, I think I killed his dad, but I'll help him, and I don't feel guilty about it. They wrote I felt guilty about it, but I'm gonna help him anyway. I'm literally gonna put him in the position that got his father killed, but I think that's the right choice. I'm a good moral compass, you know, and I really think the hero of the story should kill somebody. I'm really putting this guy's life on the line. Oh, he should fight the world title champion having just
still
boxed
better
once.
Acting.
This guy's only boxed
still
once.
Better
he
acting.
Should go up against a guy that's killed people. This guy carries guns. He's ready for the big time. I'm Rocky Balboa and I forget how boxing works.
That's I did not realize that he played Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
That was Bernie Sanders.
We got a moment for this year's clip.
All right, do we get closing arguments?
Also, like... Oh.
No, good.
Go ahead. Closing arguments.
Go ahead, Hal.
Okay. This tone deaf performance by Sylvester Stallone is so bad because you're dealing with serious material like veterans and PTSD, but he's just a non like emotional killing machine making monosyllabic. It's so bloody, so much so they had to change the tone for Rambo and make him this killing machine hero because the tone they tried in First Blood, it bottomed out. It was a mistake. All these other films, this is his wheelhouse. You're talking about films where he grew. They totally turned from what he started with.
Coy.
I mean, mine's a movie that had basically the lead take the back seat and not even accept the mighty might of Rocky Balboa. This is a movie that ended a franchise. These two films started franchises. Mine was such a defeatist film with so many tired tropes and such weak performance.
He's a 70-year-old man.
The man's performance was so weak that it literally ended a franchise that these two amazing films started. These movies shaped action genres. Mine just colored in the dots.
JT.
Hold on. This guy was an amateur that literally got lucky by making a great script with a great bunch of actors, surrounding himself with a bunch of great actors. The thing with First Blood, it's all about the physicality. What you described is exactly what that role needed. Both you and Creed, he had over 40 years to actually build a character. He had all those other movies to build upon to actually give an Oscar-winning performance, which should have been Oscar-winning performance, and everyone agreed he should have won Oscar that year. No one was yelling that he should have won Oscar for Rocky. The guy who won for Network deserved that Oscar because he absolutely killed it. Stallone was right out of the gate. He was new. He got lucky. He was the flavor of the year. But then it turned out he was not that good. And it was there from the get-go. You guys are giving much better performances. They actually have something to build upon. Whereas Rocky was literally just him playing a dumb guy from the streets. And it didn't call a lot from him.
Wow, I mean, that was... We just got JT to say, what an amateur that got lucky.
Flavor of the year.
So many great quotes there. Dan, this is the worst. Anything you'd like to fact check?
Just a couple of fact checks.
This is the worst.
Yeah, Peter
that
Finch.
Was the worst.
Peter Finch was the guy from Network.
I knew it was Peter. I didn't want to mess with
Sylvester Stallone. Michael B. Jordan says that a Creed 2 is happening. It's not an active development, but he says that there will be a sequel to Creed. A couple of fact checks on First Blood. Hal said that it was not a financial success. First Blood actually made more an unadjusted gross than the 2008 Rambo. When adjusted for inflation, it's actually the second most successful Rocky movie. I'm sorry, Rambo movie. Also, First Blood, I would not call a murder fest since it has a body count of one.
He threw a rock at somebody.
At a helicopter, I believe. But other than that, factually, other than the fact that they were all arguing completely against their souls, that's a playground. We also have the Twitter poll when you're ready. I didn't have time to check Twitter because I was laughing too hard.
I want to get our fans in here. Based on those arguments, what did you think?
I think JTE deserves an Oscar just for fighting against the soul. But...
I'm not going to sleep tonight. I'm going to go home and watch Rocky 1 through 6. And then Creed.
I think Hal did a better job talking the other two down and defending his, honestly. What? But Coy's impression was incredible.
We're just going by impressions.
Well, see, I liked Hal to start, but then my problem with Hal is I heard you say the monosyllabic delivery like 4 or 5 times. You sort of got hung up on that point, and I did feel like Coy and GT did keep punching harder. So that I did actually, I've got to knock Hal out just because I think, yes, good start. But then also the fact that he doesn't murder everybody, that was a fallacy, sort of did disqualify Hal for me. So it did come down to JT and Coy. In my mind, I thought you both did a really great job when Coy broke out the cancer trope and let another person take over the franchise. Those are really strong hits. But then, yeah, JT did really go, he's a slow, dumb guy. That's what he is, was the quote. I mean, you really went there all out knowing how hard this was for both of you to do. I think, it's a subtle edge based on those final thoughts. I think it was a subtle edge to give JTE the point. You did give me a better reason as why the other two were.
Fuck that
because
point.
I don't think it's fair. It was a good try with creating the franchise, but it clearly didn't.
Right.
And I thought you did JTE did knock the other two down as to why those performances were strong. So you did it. You got the point at least,
if
JTE.
If anybody watching this knows Stallone, tell him I'm sorry.
Yeah, you earned that point.
I'm
out of the sleepless
fan.
Nights.
I'm a huge fan.
I really thought you wouldn't win that fight because I thought you wouldn't want to go that hard, but kudos for going.
By the way, no one watching this knows Stallone.
Escape Plan 2 is on the way.
Yeah. All right, round 4. This one comes from Steve Tenser on Twitter. And the question is, what is the greatest movie stunt sequence of all time? Coy, we're back to you to start this out. Tell us what the best movie stunt is of all time. Do we have clips on this? Pictures. Oh, we didn't pull them. Okay, go ahead.
My stunt features nearly every type of stunt at once. My stunt features wire work and pole work and physical actors doing insane things, moving vehicles, 100 different variables all shot at real time. I'm, of course, talking about the incredible pole sequence in Mad Max Fury Road, where we experience not just a myriad of vehicles all being shot in real time on a practical set without CGI, but we experience actors on two-story poles diving back and forth between vehicles without the safety of wire work on them because they're transferring vehicles. These are stunts happening simultaneously in real time in motion without the aid of CGI. This was a thing that was shot for real. This stunt required months and months of practical work. This stunt shown out in a movie that was effectively 2 hours of incredible stunts. This stunt, when you watch it, you remember that moment. You remember that gasp of what is happening in a movie where you never stopped gasping. This was a highlight of just pure raw adrenaline, and I've never seen a stunt that was as amazing for cars, as amazing for people, as amazing, and there was fire. Like, it had everything you want in a stunt, and it showed that George Miller can still choreograph the hell out of a stunt scene, and that Mad Max is the franchise.
All right, JT.
I went with a classic. I'm going with Buster Keaton from Bill Jr., Buffalo Bill Jr., where the building literally falls, the whole front of the house falls right onto his character during the actual film. And look at this picture. He literally is saved from death, real life death, by having the perfect placement of standing at that spot. Not only is it a fantastic stunt, which even now in black and white when you watch it makes the hairs in the back of your head stand up, because you're literally seeing somebody possibly about to get crushed and killed, and knowing there's no safety net, there's no way to, if it was life or death. I did some research, and there's so many crazy details about how they filmed this that I'll get into more, but for me to this day still to be as thrilling and heart pumping while you're watching it tells me it is one of the best stunts ever done.
How?
Mine is Tom Cruise on the side of the building in Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol. This is one of the biggest movie stars in the world doing this thing, and we are right there along with him. For a stunt needs to get your blood boiling, needs to get you tingling, it needs to get you nervous. Action-packed, just the stakes, the placement in the movie here, and Tom Cruise laying it on the line and climbing on the side of this building. There is nothing that gives you that visceral experience, this vertigo-inducing, sweaty palms-making, pants-peeing action. Yes, I'll say it. I peed my pants in the theater, and I was on a date, and it was very unpleasant. But you know what? It was worth it. It was worth it. I went home alone that night. Andy, I hesitate to say this. I had to throw my underwear away.
Wow.
But okay. It's Tom Cruise, Mission Impossible, Ghost Protocol.
All right, guys, fight it out. Hal peed his pants.
First of all, let me just say, like, if you didn't have the publicity of them screaming at you, oh, this was actually done, I would have went and watched Ghost Protocol, and I would have been like, CG. It was probably done with CG. It's a green screen. Literally, the publicity had to make it a point.
Because it's not done. Because not done nowadays. But that man, ooh, Tom Cruise,
he
goes for it.
When I saw it, I just said, oh, this is cool. I was never scared for him. Because you know there's literally like probably a huge crane. There's every kind of safety precaution known to man in this business, keeping that guy 100% safe.
If you ask stunt guys, that safety net is like, stunt guy said, oh, it's a visually stunning performance, but yeah, he had a tether like that. Oh. There's no version of that where Tom Cruise can have like.
And there is CG in years. They had to take away some of the cables. They had to take away some of the harnesses that were holding him. So to me, it's like, yeah, it's a cool composed shot. It's a cool sequence written in the script, but it's not a great stunt. It's a guy hanging out a window. I mean, if he was bungee jumping, I'd be just as impressed. It's a guy, but at least they're jumping.
He's got a cord.
Yeah, at least they're jumping.
It is a great stunt because actors don't do that nowadays, and Tom Cruise insists on it. This stunt is very special because in this day and age, it's so rare for someone to have the composure. Look at his face. Look at his face. Look at his acting during that shot.
Because he gets a thrill out of it. He likes doing like adventurous stuff like that.
Yeah, he does. He's a very unique action movie star. That's why at 50 plus years of age, we will still go down and plunk down money for a Mission Impossible.
The question is, who is the best stuntman? It's what is the best stunt in a film? This was shot before all those safety regulations were done. He had 2 inches to his left and right. If Buster Keaton was off just 2 inches, either way, he would have been killed instantly. When they filmed it, the guys who were the PAs that were his crew at that time were praying on the side of the frame. The cameraman who shot it did not look. He turned his back because he could not believe what he was about to do. That's why today, when you watch it, it still is frightening. You watch it, you're like, oh my God, he literally could have died. There's no CG there. In your film, they stopped the camera so many times to do that shot. It's not just one continuous shot. Let's not forget that whole sequence is edited. There was over 400 hours of film. They shot it different angle here.
But it's still actually happening.
But they did actually have it. They got circus delay professionals.
Professional stunt people, as you should. But these are two stunts that only have one variable. If something like lands wrong or he didn't have his cord, mine has 100 variables, 100 different directions. 2 inches are any of those guys on poles. 2 inches are
you guys are misunderstanding the question. stunt. You guys are
all cleared up. It's what's the greatest movie stunt sequence of all time?
Yes,
so the sequence implies edits.
Yeah, saying it's less impressive to me when I know that there's a whole lot of takes going on, a lot of camera tricks, and the fact that he actually did composite other cars in there. While he did shoot a lot of real stuff, there are a lot of CGI composites.
But you mentioned that his stunt, if you knew about CGI, wouldn't be as impressive. Your stunt is one thing happening. Mine
all
is
three
so
of
much.
These are dangerous. All yes. of three of these are acceptable.
Yes, mm-hmm. and they're you're both really misunderstanding the question, because it's not about what was the most. The question is greatest movie mm-hmm. stunt sequence of all time. Whether a stunt was more dangerous while you're watching it, while you're in this movie, whether it was there was no danger whatsoever. It's about the finished product.
I disagree to a point, because you have to know what went into filming that. Like, your brain, while you're watching...
They measured a rectangle, and he stood inside the rectangle. I'm sure they dropped the damn house half a dozen times.
No, they did it. They did it one time, because they could not afford to keep doing it a bunch of other times. It was all done in one take.
Great, so they knew.
So if it's that easy, let's go buy a house.
Greatest stunt sequence is
how we'll stand there and act like nothing's going to happen, knowing that things about to fall.
Greatest stunt sequence is how you feel. Let's make a house.
I think so.
How you feel watching that moment in the movie with all the advent of today's technology, all the variables, all of our achievements in tech, we feel like either of these things could happen easily with some trickery. Mine took so many months of prep, so many variables, and so many things. It is so many more layered than either of these, because it's every type of stunt short of gun work.
Are you talking the whole car sequence?
No, that's not fair. I'm talking about the sequence wherein we zoom in and there are the pole acrobats landing on other cars, transferring off poles, and there are literally, even if they composite, we'll say at minimum 12 cars all within 6 or 7 feet of each other. If you've been on the highway, you're going any sort of speed, and there's people jumping on your car, that's always exciting.
Hey,
moves.
Coy.
This has
have you been to Cirque du Soleil?
I've seen guys climb stuff, and I've seen things fall.
You're picking acrobats doing something they're amazing at. Also, why that sequence out of an entire movie that's just a practical ride?
Well,
I don't see that sequence standing out.
Yours has stuff coming down. Mine has everything.
At the end of the day, yours is just guys on a stick while cars are driving. Yeah. It's not that impressive.
Basically, and you're taking one thing out of a whole action, out of like one, the movie is one big stunt.
Absolutely. But this is a highlight in stunts. If the whole movie's a stunt, this one stands out. That shows how good the stunt is. A guy going up and a thing falling down is not exciting. It's one action. This is a myriad of actions simultaneously with a plot-driven point. That those guys are handling plot points while the movie's happening.
Yeah, bad guys try to get good guys.
Not even the best stunt, I think, in that movie. There's maybe two other three scenes in that
like
movie.
What?
For one, the 18-wheeler, when it turns, they actually did that. A guy actually had to be in that car and turn it, and they only did one take because it was so damaged and huge and impressive and dangerous that it was the last shot of the film. It's where the steering wheel, which is the only part of CGI, is when the steering wheel goes right into the
camera.
But
a car crashing, I've seen that. And a guy climbing, I've seen. A thing falling, I've seen. I've never seen guys leaping from car to car simultaneously while going forward, while it serves the plot, while the speed
Terminator
is a factor,
3,
while the variables are
Terminator
a factor.
3 Rise of the Machines. Literally, you got Arnold in a giant arm while there's a crane while it's going down.
There are individual moments from Fast 6 in the races on the road that are more impressive than that road stunt. Maybe like the danger wasn't as impressive. Listen, if you read the you've got the most impressive one maybe in a director's commentary. We're talking about the best movie stunt sequence, and this is a movie star, a guy who could retire tomorrow and never think about doing anything of this stuff again, putting it on the line, using these gloves, and yeah, of course they're not going to let Tom Cruise die, okay? But as far as the finished product, the polished thing that gives you, here's the beat all end all for me, that it gives you the most emotion. It tickles your insides. It gives you butterflies. Tom Cruise on the side of that building does it more than any of these. Yours is a quick moment. Yours is part of one big
taking that
hole.
As your final thoughts. Go ahead, JT.
They do, in the Mission Impossible 2, Tom Cruise literally does the same thing in a way. There's a scene in the beginning where he's climbing a rock and he has to jump from one part of the cliff to the other. No harness, nothing is seen. Tom Cruise had to fight and get his own insurance company just to have that scene filmed. John Woo, the director, cannot look. So it's something I've already seen in that franchise, two films before it. Yes, it's a prettier setup for that shot. It's a more famous building, but it's, again, it's the same stunt that he already done two films earlier. And he even kind of did it in part three when he was sliding down the glass building. Like, I've seen that before. Buster Keaton, when he did that, it was unlike anything it had ever done before. The only people that have done something like it before was Buster Keaton when he was hanging off the Big Ben clock in one of his earlier films. This one just took that and once upstaged it. When Buster Keaton was interviewed, he said that was the most proud he ever been of a stunt in his whole career because he literally put his life on the line. And the fact that it's black and white, it's a silent film, and I could watch it today and still just be like scared out of my mind and feel the hair on my arm stand. I'd be like, oh my God, that is terrifying. I would never do it. You put enough harnesses on me, I'll go on a pole in a car. You throw me with a crane or a bunch of other ropes, I'll go bungee jumping or hang off a wall for a little bit. I ain't letting a building fall upon me if I'm 1 inch off and kill me.
Okay.
You both mentioned compositing and the things combined together. I would argue everything you just mentioned is true, but this is all of those things put together. It is the Fast 6 stunt. It is the Terminator 3 stunt. It's all those at once, simultaneously. His stunt in that movie was then augmented in the next movie by having it on a plane. He's still tethered the same way. It's still something. It's even higher because it's in a plane. I saw that stunt be defeated by himself 2 years later. I've seen things fall and been struck by it, many Jackie Chan things. If you look at Ong Bak, Tony Jaa dives through a barbed wire circle less than half an inch in diameter. So your 2 inches, very exciting. Half an inch is more exciting.
He would have died. Mine, he would have just got cut up.
Mine is, so he did the same stunt, but it's even less room for error.
Jumping through a hole?
He jumped through a ring of barbed wire, so he had to move a leap. He didn't have control of that. That I thing understand. Fell. Yours, he beat himself with his next movie. Mine is all of the stunts from the 80s and 90s that we love with cars, with pole work, with the surgical acrobatics at once with hundreds of variables. These had one variable each. Mine, there's never been anything quite like it. There's been pieces like it. There's never been this many tactics like it.
I wish I could respond.
Dan, anything you'd like to clean up?
Yeah, just a couple things. I believe JT said Buffalo Bill Jr. Steamboat.
Steamboat Bill, sorry. Yeah. I'll sing the signs of lyrics. I'll sing the signs of lyrics.
Also, you made one little misstep. Buster Keaton wasn't the one who hung from the clock. It was Harold Lloyd who hung from the clock.
Buster Keaton also did a clock trick, though, I believe.
He may have.
In one of his earlier films.
The most famous clock hang is, of course, Harold Lloyd.
Yeah, I confused it with another film.
Yeah, so that's factually, that's about it. I mean, you know, this. Everybody was pretty. It's a stunt sequence. It's stunt. There's semantics. I would have had not a field day with that. But yeah, no. I don't envy your job on this fight.
No, this is a tough one, actually. That's why I'm activating KC and Connor. What do you think based on those arguments?
Well, personally, Mad Max, I rewatched all the freaking time,
and that
sequence is absolutely stunning. And I've been to circus school, so I know how difficult some of the tricks that you have to do. It's absolutely physically taxing. So. My personal choice is Mad Max, but I liked the passion from JT over a silent film.
I mean, Mad Max is my favorite movie at all.
I've seen that sequence so many times over that it's just so stunning.
Have
and
you seen
intricate.
The Buster Keaton sequence?
I watched it over Dan's shoulder. seen it. Yes.
All right, good thoughts. This one is tough for me. Here's where I got stuck. You were so focused on the danger of your scene. It is a very dangerous scene. It's an iconic, historic scene. It's a great scene. You should all see it. But then you were sort of not listening to the others of like you clarified and said that Mad Max was just a guy in a stick while a car is driving. It's a lot more dangerous.
I'm trying to win a fight.
I couldn't get over the fact of like how sort of both of you were sort of trying to shrug away the danger in Mad Max, which was in the hundreds of variables, is completely true with moving cars, crashing, stunts, moving, the flexibility of things. So you did a good job defeating that argument. So that was hard to go. And then, so when you were talking about this, since you were so focused on the danger, I couldn't just accept that yours is the most dangerous because they're really, both of these actually have, even though he's on a cord, Tom Cruise, if that cord at all frayed, he's dead. So these were all very dangerous. And that's where a lot of this got hung up. So I'm trying to focus on the rest of your points. It really came down to the fact that I think Hal got so hung up on, he's a big star, he does his own stunts. I thought Coy really did give me more about why it was more of a plot point, why the danger was there, but a little bit more as to why that really is a memorable shot in a movie full of nonstop gasp, as you said. you really do remember those guys going back and forth on the polls. So I got to give Coy, based on the arguments, the point.
The funny thing, Jordan Miller originally wanted to do it CGI because he just said, there's no way we could do that.
We can't do that.
And then the stunt guys were like, no, we can do it.
Give me a week. I would
not go on a pole.
Yeah, I'd do that in the desert.
Not in especially not hearing about like Tom Hardy saying how hard that movie was. There's no chance I would do that.
He brought a stunt guy with him.
I would probably do the measurements and do the math to know the house is going to hit me here. As not to throw shade at Buster Keaton. Totally risky, but
what's the score?
Probably a little more valuable.
For the record, I do none of those
things. I'd probably do the house over both of those.
No.
Just because you can do the math.
Yeah. Well, but if you're 2 inches off, you're dead.
Yeah, well, 2 inches off on either of these, and you're dead.
Yeah, 2 inches off on any of these.
This guy's had so much more.
What would you guys do at home? Tell us on Movie Fights Live. Which stunt would you prefer to do? That's a fun question.
Yeah.
What did the poll say, Dan?
The poll, well, do I need to...
Yeah, I mean, it's Mad Max.
Yeah,
it's Mad Max. Close. Listen, if it was like
all
best
three stunts,
stunts
though.
If it was best stunts in the complete movie, Mad Max hands down.
How about a two-hour stunt movie?
Well, JT, if it helps, you're already in the round. You already have 2 points, so Hal and Coy, this match really, this last round really is all for all the marbles.
Oh, this is
interesting. All right, let's do this. In honor of Champ's Choice, we wanted to do something a little bit aimed at Dan. So we want to ask this silly question. Mm. Who should direct a remake of Dan's favorite film, Jaws? This is a blind fight. Mm-hmm. Ooh, you guys don't get to pick. We've put in about, 10 or so, 8 or 10? Really, these are all 8, 10 legit directors.
We're
not joking you this time.
All right.
You have 8 to 10 directors that are very, any of these could do an interesting take. So don't look. Reach your hand in there, Coy, and see who you're going to pick. Let's reveal. What'd you get, Coy?
Oh.
Jordan Peele.
Oh, wow, interesting.
All right, JTE, who are you picking?
I have... Ooh, Darren Aronofsky, I like that.
Okay, and how?
The Coen brothers.
Ooh, okay, nice. All right. These are three different Jaws movies.
Yeah.
Completely at random. JT, you are up first. Take a second.
Okay.
I will check in with Dan. Dan, what do you think of these choices as they give him a few minutes just to think?
Well, these are three directors that would soften the blow of hearing that they are remaking Jaws.
For sure.
My thing on remakes is always, or reboots or whatever, is always, what are you going to do differently?
Mm-hmm.
And what are you going to do that's going to add to what's already been done? So these are three directors with very specific styles, so it should be a very interesting round.
All right, well, JT, do you think you're good to go?
I think so. I think I have a seed of an idea.
Tell us again. You got Darren Aronofsky. Okay.
I'll start off by saying if this was the director out of these three, this is the one I'd be most excited about. Let's talk about a little bit what makes Jaws work. People think about this thing that started the big summer blockbuster, had these great scares, but really what it had more than anything was great characters. And for me, that's what makes Jaws a great movie. It's that I care about those three guys on the boat. I care about what their life has been, what they're going through. I mean, the best scene to me in that movie is not even really a shark scene. It's when they're talking about Quint's time in the Navy when the boat went down, the sharks were picking them off one by one. He's like, they had doll's eyes. Darren Aronofsky knows how to get into the mind and soul of a character. Look at a movie like The Wrestler. To me, maybe his best film because of Mickey Rourke's performance and because Darren Aronofsky was able to get that performance from Mickey Rourke. I wanted, for this Jaws movie, we're going to go, it's soul searching. I want there to be a soul to the movie. So we're going to follow a character like Quint. We're going to, no, this is a remake, right? Is it
remake? Yes.
So this movie is going to focus on Quint, a man who's been broken down, is in search of something for meaning in his life. He's a drunk. He's miserable. The only time he feels alive when he's out there fishing. I'm going to take it almost like in a Moby Dick kind of direction. He becomes obsessed. He has a dark soul. He becomes obsessed because of what happened to him with those sharks picking off him and all his friends. He has this deep, dark revenge that's been building him for all these years. When he hears about this shark attacking this small town, he's not doing it for money. He's doing it because it is a chance for him to tackle a thing that's haunting him his whole life. And if we're remaking it, let's go ahead and reteam him with Mickey Rourke. He is this character. He is literally just torn down. And for me to actually care about this guy and actually know that he's going out to kill the shark because of what's happening inside of him, because it's something that he needs for closure, something that's eating away his life, his family is broken up, because everything all that bad happened to him is because of what happened when these sharks took away his family, his friends, when he was in the army. So I'm going to take Darren Aronofsky in a dark, gritty, character-driven movie about chasing a shark, which really is a metaphor for the thing that ruined his life.
All right, Hal. Who'd you get? Coen Brothers?
I got the Coen Brothers. And they are absolutely the best choice out of this because they've, no pun intended, they've navigated so many different waters as far as the tones of their film. And this would be a perfect film for them to direct because the way the shark, you fear the shark, but you don't quite know the shark. You don't spend too much time with the shark. They would honor that. Similarly, I keep thinking about Anton Chigurh from No Country for Old Men, where this sinister, just epically created villain, they would use that same kind of cat and mouse game as they did with that character with this shark. And then you want to talk about depth of characters. Oh, these are the men who delve into different genres, like Inside Llewyn Davis, so many different characters of depth, and they can create those characters that resonate. Like Inside Llewyn Davis, Blood Simple, Barton Fink, they have these characters who, wow, you are like, you want to get inside a character's head, JT? Watch Barton Fink, more so than any Darren Aronofsky film.
Coy, your turn. You got Jordan Peele.
I got Jordan Peele, and I was very happy I got Jordan Peele because I feel that this is the man, on a surface level, is the one that would have the most to prove going forward. He did his first movie, which was a sweeping success, and usually when you have a movie that is that strong coming out the gate, Marvel or someone ends up swooping you up and you do a studio film where you lose some control. I feel like Jordan Peele would not let that happen with Jaws. That movie has too much legacy at stake. This man would take control of the film. This man just did a film where you're instantly familiar with all the characters that you just met, where you instantly empathize with everyone you've just met, where it is, I agree completely with what you're saying about Jaws being a character-driven movie. Jaws doesn't work if it's a shark movie. Jaws works if it's a movie about people that are afraid of something haunting them, the unknown. Get Out was a great illustration of you feeling for characters you've just met and worrying about the unknown. Jordan Peele made a beautiful movie about the suburbs where you are afraid of a backyard. If that isn't a great parallel with an ocean of mystery, I don't know what is. The man made a movie where you're never going to be in a situation like that. You're not going to be in a world where you're at a barbecue and everyone's treating you like that, because that it was a beautiful subversive commentary and a beautiful humorous commentary. Jaws can be that. Jaws has this amazing ability. You referenced, I totally agree again, with the fact that you need to love them to fear the shark, and the shark is a metaphor for everything going wrong. Jordan Peele just made a movie where one thing goes wrong and it affects every character. The wife and his life crumbling can be reflected easily with Jordan Peele's ability to make your character so instantly likable and so haunting. He uses music beautifully. He uses nuance and iconic shots beautifully. The man creates a painting with so little, and that's got to be important for a movie on a boat.
All right, I heard a little bit, and kudos to DJGT for delivering this since he went first, but I heard a little bit more about what his movie is.
Okay.
So Hal and Coy, if you now go to Hal first, but like, what is the Coen Brothers' take on Jaws?
The Coen Brothers' take on Jaws is the death of the American dream. We are in a beautiful Pacific quiet summer town. People are on vacation. It's beautiful. It's joyous. And you can bring in some of the humor of the Coen brothers. And then that quietude, that peacefulness is ripped asunder by this shark. And it's basically the shark coming and destroying people's innocence while they're at their most vulnerable. And the Coen brothers would absolutely be able to helm that kind of movie. They'd be able to establish characters who are enjoying themselves, that have peace of mind, that have the confidence that life is good, and then use this shark to rip that peace out from under them.
Coy?
Jordan Peele's Jaws would be a commentary on loss. It would be a commentary on placing anger and frustration on something that isn't actually the problem. There's no way that we'd exist in a 2017, you can't have a shark movie that blames the shark, but that's exactly what our leads would do. This would be a movie where a man is suffering through either a midlife crisis or something going horribly wrong, where he has no one to blame but the shark. It's almost Moby Dick-like. It's almost like something where something outside of his control pushes the narrative forward, much like the film he just did, Get Out, where all those things are not reality. They're above reality. A shark attacking you on a boat and having that be a full thing has to be slightly above reality. This is a movie where you drive the narrative by Quint and these people dealing with loss and remorse and aggression and blaming something that's out of their control, and it would have to be done in not tongue-in-cheek but in a commentary way, and in a way that alludes to more than the actual shark is. And I think Jordan Peele, he made a racial movie, a very not racial with it, with the style it was, and this movie about a shark can be about loss and can be about dealing with what it feels like to blame everything but what you can control.
I will say this, the characters that you're talking about in Jordan Peele's movie, like the side characters, aren't as three-dimensional as the characters in Coen Brothers movies. The leads were okay, and as a whole, what an amazing debut and a great film. But that deft hand with characters, you can't even put it in the same sentence as what the Coen Brothers do. Check out the side characters in The Big Lebowski. Man, everyone is made a meal out of it. There's by like the Coen Brothers.
Is your movie a comedy?
Mine's certainly not a comedy.
You both describe things that are way different than Jaws, because Jaws is not Moby Dick, fellas. And you describe Moby Dick, and you name checked Moby Dick.
I'm not trying to psycho this. I'm not trying to make a shot for shot remake. I want to find some of the things that were explored in the original movie, especially with Quint's story.
I'm talking about putting
it out a little bit more.
In that beach town. I mean,
mine's going to be the beach town also.
They're all in the beach town.
I'm the only one in my description that talked about that innocence, that peacefulness being torn asunder by the shark.
We're making different movies than you.
you're remaking Moby Dick with Charles Lawton.
No, I'm not. Basically, I want to really go on Quint. Like, he is the black sheep of this town. It's a small-knit town, and he's the outcast. And Mickey Rourke could play that fantastically because he's done it in previous
Mickey
films.
Mickey Rourke's been a caricature of himself ever since The Wrestler. That would be awful. He ruined Iron Man 2.
Why is those two? Why are Jordan Peele and Coen Brothers not suited
again
for this?
I don't know who your characters are, really. You've told me a lot of general things. I'm literally focusing on the single character. The other characters from the movie are there, but they're all second-guessing him. They're putting him down. He's the outcast. I feel like, for Jaws to mean something, I need for it to have some sort of something that has to do with his soul. Something, he needs to be a redemption. It has to be some sort of something driving him to kill this beast. And with Quint being the main character and actually trying to take out some demons by taking out this demon of a shark, to me, it would make it so much more interesting. And I think Aronofsky is the best director out of these three to really pull off the kind of tone that I'm going for and what Jaws would need. I'll cast mine for you.
The Coen Brothers. How about Oscar Isaac in the Roy Scheider role? How about Woody Harrelson in the Quint role? He would nail that.
What's different about their characters from the original?
I'll tell you, Woody Harrelson, he's ex-military, and now you can bring in modern themes and
modern day telling.
Yeah.
Jordan Peele literally just made a movie about a fish out of water, and he literally made a movie where you instantly feel for the first character.
This is not a fish out of water story, you're being too literal.
Quint made two films, and one's not that good, and the second one is a really good Twilight Zone episode.
But this, and Jaws is about a man who doesn't feel welcome in his own shoes anymore. This is a man who doesn't feel welcome in that environment.
He hasn't shown the deafness. You said it was a character-driven, or one of you said it was a character-driven movie. Jordan Peele has not yet shown the deafness with characters.
Who's a great character from a Jordan Peele film?
He only has the one that was really his own.
What was the character's name? You pulled the rug out from under yourself, JT,
by bringing Mickey Rourke. Mickey Rourke is only a caricature of himself.
I only have one to pull from, whereas the Coens have 20, and I love the Coen Brothers, but the pacing of this is the closest to a summer movie that it needs to be. Darren Aronofsky makes amazing character films, and I love the Coen Brothers in their comedy and their drama. Pacing-wise, Jordan Peele just made a summer movie as his first practically debut. I know he had another one.
Not a summer movie. Not at all.
It clipped along beautifully. You cared about everyone, and the most beautiful thing about this movie...
Define a summer movie, because that is... Get Out is...
The most beautiful thing about what this movie was is most of the actors were either character actors or unknowns, and I want that for my Jaws. I want characters we don't already associate with 100 other roles. I don't want your Mickey Rourke's. I don't want your Woody Harrelson's. I want actors I don't know, and I want to care about them instantly, and Jordan Peele did that for me. And Get Out? Every single character was fascinating, okay. And you understood their narratives, even when it was insane, and even when it was something that was
I thought the characters were utilitarian for the story in Get Out. And you called Get Out a summer movie? You don't know what a summer movie is. A summer movie. A blockbuster. Yeah, it's not
different.
A summer movie.
I'm saying blockbusters and blockbuster movies are different.
No, it's not a summer movie. Get Out is not a summer movie. Yeah. Get Out is a more contained movie. It doesn't have the tone, the pacing of a summer movie.
It has the pacing
completely
of
different. Completely different. Jaws is the first summer blockbuster.
I agree.
And you're not going to put that in the hands of someone who hasn't dealt with that amount of
story. Final thoughts, Hal. JT, final thoughts.
Film today has changed a lot since Jaws. I think Darren Aronofsky could build the tension and darkness, the grittiness that a new Jaws movie would need to be successful and have that tension. Black Swan has some of the most tense moments in any kind of horror thriller that I've seen in years. And he did it with a ballerina. Imagine if he had a huge great white shark with a great actor, great cinematography, and he knows how to use special effects. And he won't do it. He won't do over CGI. I'm worried about Jordan Peele. He might not know how to do an effects-driven movie, or at least make it realistic. All the films that I've seen Darren Aronofsky does, even when it's fantastical, he still made it feel grounded and real. And that's what I think Jaws needs to be, a great film. It needs to feel real, have a great character, and it has to have a soul. And I think he can do all those.
In one movie, Jordan Peele made me believe an out-of-this-world plot. And I believe Jaws has so many elements that can be spoofed easily and can be done poorly that you need a man who can make something that unrealistic work in real time. He made the unknown the fear. He made something that you didn't understand the scary thing. Jaws is about fearing the unknown. And I think in my version where it's about like loss and remorse and displaced anger and aggression, because that's what I feel like the shark represents to me, I feel like this man created a narrative where you can have something that's so human feel so inhuman. And Jordan Peele did that with one movie. I can't argue the 20 films and the you know amazing seven films. I can say that with the single bit of exposure, I believe he's just as strong, if not stronger, of a contender, and he's going to work harder than either of these. These men can lean in their credentials. Jordan Peele has done one movie that made $100 million instantly and will have a harder time working for it. He has more to prove, and Jordan Peele will work twice as hard at making Jaws the movie it needs to be.
He's not the right choice.
All right, Dan. Anything to add up there?
The USS Indianapolis.
That's what it was. I was trying to remember.
Quint served on. Hal referred to, of course, his movie would take place in a Pacific summer town. The original Jaws was in an Atlantic summer town. JT, I think you said that Jordan Peele had two films to his credit. He has actually only directed one film. He did not direct Keanu.
Oh, he didn't direct Keanu.
Yeah.
Oh,
he
interesting.
Did not direct Keanu.
Peter Tencio.
Interesting.
They wrote it, right? With
they basically co-directed.
JTE. Some people on Twitter noticed your endearing nickname for Darren Aronofsky, which is Darrenofsky.
Darrenofsky.
I like referred to
it's the Darrenofsky. I just shipped them together.
And I will confine myself to one piece of editorial on this round, which was Hal's statement saying that Jaws is not Moby Dick. Jaws is exactly Moby Dick.
Yeah, I said that from the get-go.
Sorry.
Well, my other favorite moment is when JT got mad for Coy at stealing the Moby Dick comparison, where it's like, that's... Yeah. They're all...
I gave you the hand.
I got it, but it sounded like you were pitching a different movie. I was turning
what you had said and said, like, I agree.
I pitched Moby Dick. It's like, you're all pitching Moby Dick because it's all Moby Dick.
I was like, I agree.
But it sounded like you were pitching a different movie than when you said that. I was like, no, wait. Okay, what?
I was like, I'm giving credit.
All right. Based on the arguments, it came down to me of... Hal, I think you just got... I still don't know what movie you're pitching. Just because the town is set asunder didn't really paint the full picture to me. It didn't work for me there. It came down between JTE and Coy, who I thought gave me a little bit more. Coy, I thought you were definitely on the ropes there because they were definitely getting you with their people, but I thought you stood pretty tall against a lot of that stuff. The unknown, he just made unknown the fear in that movie. Really good, the fact that he's going to step this up. And then it's sort of the argument about, is Get Out a summer movie? I mean, I could see why the argument there is that it could be. It's very successful, has those sort of moments, and it escalates. Okay. As a horror movie, I could have saw that doing well. So... That seems silly, but JT, you had an amazing start. Your start was fantastic out the gate with the great characters and the focus on Quint, and even the wrestler comparison was really strong. So it came down to that. Do we go with sort of the proven record or to the someone who's going to give it new? And by the end, I got to say, Coy swung me over with the Jordan Peele. I thought you did a good job fighting uphill against that, and you actually swayed me because I was rooting for Darren.
I thought I had
it. And then you just really did a really good job, I thought. So I'm going to give Coy the point there. There you go. You did it.
I'm curious to hear what Dan's.
Dan, what would you have now that the three.
What would you like to see?
I think that Coy sold me the most on this idea of the unknown and the fact that we just saw that he was capable of that, of creating suspense and tension. I think you could have won easily and really trumped these two guys if you would have pointed out that at this point of making Jaws, Spielberg and Peele were at the exact same point in their careers.
Oh,
a director who's made one movie and is known for television work,
that's
and they said
point,
they
yeah.
can't handle a movie that big.
That's
well, guess what?
That's
you guys who did? Steven Spielberg.
You still got there, I thought. Really good argument. All right, guys, time for the speed round. You know how this works. Let's get to it. That means Hal. Very good fight. You did get the point, so kudos and great job. You are now going to have to help me decide this winner along with our fans on the couch. But we come in with 2-2, Coy to JT, and we are doing the speed round. 20 seconds each. You guys know how to play this. Let's do it. Number one. It was recently revealed that we will learn Han Solo's real name in his standalone film. What should Han Solo's real name be?
Oh, before Han Solo?
Yeah, someone speak.
3, 2, 1.
Hank Solan.
Hold on, Coy, you gotta speak.
Han Skylander.
Okay, we got, sorry, Hank Solan, what is it?
Solan.
Hank Solan.
Those are so sacrilegious, I feel like
Solan. Okay, and then who was it?
Han Skylander, Skywalker.
Han
technically
Skywalker.
He said Skylander.
He said Skylander.
I meant to say Skywalker, but I got too high.
Right. Skylander. Skylander is what you're stuck with.
Bob Dole.
Wait, that would have been rough. I'm kind of curious where it was going to go with Skywalker.
Yeah, that would have been where I went.
Might have been a better move that you didn't. Anyway.
Considering
here we go.
That he has a Hank, kid with a he would have
Hank,
a kid with
Hank
a,
Solan?
Hank Solan.
Hank Solan. Skylander. All right, JT, you're first.
Okay. Real quick, hold on. All right, so we meet Hank Solan in this prequel film where we get to find out who Han Solo is. He meets Woody Harrelson, this guy who teaches him all these things, and he's already like a bachelor. He's doing great. He's a scoundrel. Ladies love him. He's good with his gun. He's one of the best pilots. But the whole movie, people keep making fun of him because of his name. The whole film, it keeps undercutting how cool of a guy he is. So finally, at the end of the film, right when the credits... I'll
say it. You got 10 seconds to finish it later. Coy, why Han Skylander?
George Lucas loved names that are very on the nose. I feel like Skylander implies both of his pilot skill and everything else, but he was too sick of being compared to Skywalkers and thinking that was a thing, so he changed it to Solo in order to devise his more roguish nature. He wouldn't make a name a joke, and he wouldn't change and undermine Harrison Ford's authority by making that a pun. The man used Skylander for as long as he did and then changed it to Solo to show his general personality and type.
JT.
George Lucas is not writing this film. This is a Disney film that has nothing to do with this. I think the reason why he literally gets his mentor, gives his name. He goes, drop the K, drop the N. He's Han Solo. He wants you to be who he wants to be.
10 seconds for Coy.
Dropping two letters is like that silly thing with Black Bolt being Black Boltagon that did not work. Skylander is a thing that actually would have to be changed in order for it to work. And George Lucas will be referenced and nodded with love, and that is why his original name was something that direct and that George Lucas-y.
All right, I'm gonna go on record saying these both suck.
Yeah, they're horrible.
Gosh.
They're horrible.
But it's not about them. It's about the arguments. It's about the debate show. We're going to you, Hal, first. Based on the arguments, who'd you pick?
Out of the four arguments we heard, Coy's first round was the strongest, and because of that, I would give him the point. I felt like JT kind of just described the plot of the movie, whereas Coy like dealt more with the name.
I explained how it would be working.
Casey?
I would agree. I liked Coy's opening, and then... I liked his takedown at the end against JT. He did just really talk about the plot in the first opening. Mm. So I agree with Hal.
Interesting. Yeah. I mean, I did like sort of, you did point out part of it just because we're dropping the letters. I just didn't hear enough combating against Koi's there. They're both stupid.
That was a weird question. I felt like I had to build a story around it.
I heard a little bit more from Koi. I'm going to give Koi the point first.
But for the record, I would have gone with Leon Steinberg.
Damn it, Hal, why aren't you in the speedrun?
Okay, here we go. We have normal ones.
He was on a path to become a space rabbi and then had a change of course.
Best movie spaceship.
Discovery One.
Spaceship from the Lego Movie.
Okay, spaceship versus spaceship versus Discovery One. You spoke first. So Discovery One.
Discovery One is the best spaceship in movies because it was one of the first spaceship movies to actually come off as a real spaceship. Not to mention that it literally is about 80% of the film is the setting for this film. This film is all about atmosphere, and Stanley Kubrick, with his perfect lens, used a ship to make the mode of the film, and it gave us one of the greatest villains, which is a part of the ship, HAL 2000. What else do I need to say except for that it is the movie? Without it, the movie does not work.
Koi?
Not only does my movie get hyped the entire movie, so you're waiting, and it's a plot point, an amazing moment when you actually find out what spaceship is, and it's a narrative plot of the film, it can be any spaceship. Lego is canon, and Lego has every narrative, so I can be the Discovery One, I can be the Millennium Falcon, I can be the Slave One. Spaceship is the ultimate spaceship because it is all spaceship. Spaceship is spaceship.
Wow. He brought it out.
I love spaceship!
All right, and he still had time. JT.
That is not true. When he finally builds a spaceship, it is a crappy looking little spaceship. I don't even remember what it looks like, to be honest with you. And this is a small narrative part of the point that just fills a small plot hole. The Discovery One is the whole movie. And it is one of the most cinematic films ever.
10 seconds.
You say Discovery One, it does not listen to motion. You yell spaceship, you hear Charlie Day's voice, you remember the movie Lego Movie, you remember where you got to the Lego Movie, and that thing is fueled by imagination. It can go as fast as it wants. It can do whatever it wants. It is the ultimate spaceship because it's run by everything the writers intended it to be.
I don't know about that.
Ooh, all right. Well, fastest goes to Koi.
Yeah,
it's not about that. It's about the arguments, and I'm going to Casey on the couch first.
In there.
Based on the arguments.
A lot of words. That all makes sense.
I felt like that was on fast forward, like I was watching a movie, because I could not follow half of it. I really liked Koi's argument. I would give the slight edge to JTE just for kind of poking holes at Koi's, but...
Yeah, I loved Koi's argument, actually, of the it can be, but then I think JT's rebuttal was pretty spot on of what? I don't remember what it was like. Spaceship, it was pretty unbelievable.
It's like a Batman, you can combine.
I barely remember what it was like. But Hal, what do you think?
I initially liked Koi's argument, but then I was like, I didn't remember it as much. And just as far as like a more memorable thing that has an identity of its own, I feel like partially Koi's argument might have undermined him a little bit because, it could be all these different things. Great. It would be all these iconic ships that are better than that one. I think I...
all right, we're on agreement. It's a tie game again. 3-3. Here we go. Number 3.
HAL 9000.
HAL 9000.
Oh, 9000.
Yes,
I say 2000?
I will not open the pod bay doors.
It was 2001.
What is the best movie featuring Wesley Snipes?
Ooh.
I'm going to go with...
Blade.
White Man Can't Jump.
Okay. White Man Can't Jump versus Blade. Koi, you're up first this time. Best movie featuring
Wesley Snipes.
Blade was an R-rated superhero made in a time that superhero movies were not taken seriously. It was more than a superhero movie. It allowed for a black vampire movie to be taken seriously. It took itself in a narrative path that worked. The villain was great. He was great. The story was great. It's memorable. The opening lab scene, the opening rave scene is still to this day one of the best comic scenes of all time. And the movie itself worked. You felt for the characters. You empathized with the villain and the hero. And every supporting character was fleshed out.
Ooh. JT.
White Man Can't Jump was a huge hit in the 90s because of the chemistry of Wesley Snipes and Woody Harrelson, but Wesley Snipes' character had the physicality and the comedy to go together with it. Also, it's one of Stanley Kubrick's favorite films. It was a hit without being a big comic book property. It didn't have explosions. It was just a great comedy that lives on and is even right now being talked to be remade because it's such a good film. No talks of Blade being remade because it's dead property.
I don't care who liked it. I don't care how well he did. I don't care he looked like the thing. People do talk about Blade all the time, and it is a movie that is more fleshed out. It has more characters you remember. I only remember those two guys in it. I remember everyone supporting and lead in that film, and it is stronger to this day, not time.
White Man Can't Jump made a star out of Woody Harrelson and Wesley Snipes and Rosie Perez. Not to mention that it was directed by Ron Livingston, one of the greater directors who did Bull Durham. He just...
White Man Can't Jump was one of Stanley Kubrick's
favorite films of all time.
Stanley Kubrick's favorite films included The Jerk and White Men Can't Jump.
Wow, okay.
Deep cut.
And he hated The Wizard of Oz.
Oh, wow.
Oh. Use that later somewhere.
All right, based on those arguments, coming to you first, Hal, what did you think?
Tell me again the exact way the question was worded.
Best please. Movie featuring Wesley Snipes.
You know what? At the end of the day, damn, I think I heard more from JTE.
Let's go to the couch. Casey,
have you seen White Man Can't Jump?
I've seen parts of it. So,
but based off the arguments.
So I know about the same from both. I'm going to pull a Dan and say it would be 51-49% one way or the other. I would lean just slightly towards Coy because he said that his movie was a little more fleshed out. And based on the question, I liked how he answered it more, but... 51-49.
It's close. So it's on me. I thought I got a little bit more as to why the movie was better from Coy. Slight edge for me as well. I just thought he gave me more about just all the examples you listed. So I got to give Coy that first.
What's the score now?
That one hurt. You need to get this, JT.
I know. Yeah, I thought JT I had that one. Damn it.
Here we go. What two other superheroes should get a film built around them fighting a la Batman v Superman? Ten seconds.
Two superheroes. Spider-Man and Venom.
I'm going to say Loki and Doctor Strange.
Can I hear the question again, please?
What two other superheroes should get a film built around them fighting a la Batman v Superman?
Is that a superhero?
They both picked villains.
Villains.
Venom is Flash Thompson. He's a military. He works for the U.S. government. He's a. I mean, if you look him up right now,
he's known as a bad guy, though.
Since they both picked villains,
they
I'll
both picked
it.
Villains, so or, whatever.
Okay. We're going to do another question. I just thought that Venom is a good guy.
I see what you're saying because it says Batman v Superman, which are two heroes, which I didn't think about.
They both did the same thing.
I'm fine with our question.
Yeah. All right.
It's up to you, Andy.
Let's hear it.
All right.
You're up first, Coy.
The comic community has waited years to see Venom on screen. Venom has the best, richest history of Spider-Man. He literally the symbiote that when he was with Venom, he knows all the secrets. He's compassionate with him. Flash Thompson is now the hero playing Venom, and Flash and Spider-Man best friends. There's layers of nuance. There's layers of characterization already built into the characters. And visually, Venom on screen would be a beautiful thing, and you can use all the CGI of modern day to make that visually stunning. Both characters have a rich history, and both have a lot to go on.
Everybody, JT.
At the end of Doctor Strange, Thor visits Doctor Strange and literally tells him that he has to watch out for his brother. I think the best thing about it is because the two different characters, even though they both deal in magic, they have so different personalities. Doctor Strange is a straight-laced, no-comedy kind of guy, where Loki is a villain. And to see their powers, and really more about the mind games, using their smarts against each other with their powers will make great dynamic for a fight, with also just the characters actually be going jarring against each other.
10 seconds.
Mine is still a hero in that he wants to protect people. That would give it a lot more nuance than Loki, who just wants to create mischief. Mine wants to protect and serve. He just does it incorrectly because he thinks he's always right. Spider-Man has been dealing with this character for years in the comics.
10 seconds.
Loki's already been built up the Marvel MCU. He's a marquee player. No one wants to see Venom anymore. They have a sour taste. And he's so similar to Spider-Man. They have the same powers. Venom just has a scarier looking face. There's nothing new there to actually from the interact.
Ooh, all right. I'll show my cards first. I thought I was with Coy, but then JT actually gave me a really good burn at the end. So that swayed me at the end. It was neck and neck, a little bit Coy, but better closing for me. Hal, where are you going?
Man, damn it, this is tough. Let's have a round of applause for both these
guys. Yes.
Damn, I hate choosing either one of these because you both, I mean, JTE set up more of a conventional plot than going up against each other. But much like Batman for Superman, Coy hit on that there is a groundswell. This is fan service. And so much of that is that's a powerful force in making a film or an idea resonate. And that is the deciding factor.
I gotta go Coy, but also Casey and I were saying Deadpool versus Wolverine.
That would have been good.
Good call.
That would have been good. All right, but you picked Coy as well. Mm-hmm. Okay,
I changed my answer. I go with that.
Have a chair, man.
Yeah, that would have been a good one.
It still comes down to me. So, yeah. See, but I'm stuck on. I didn't hear why Loki and Doctor Strange were bad.
Do you want to do another 10?
No, because you had your time.
I'm sorry. That's right.
And JT did give me a better reason why Venom was bad, the sour taste, mm-hmm. and we've seen the same powers. So I am going to stick and overrule and give JT that point.
This is it.
And I think this also just sets up a fairer way to get there for the end, I think. So let's do it. Here we go. This is an interesting one. You have to watch the same movie 4 times in 1 day. What movie do you pick?
Dark City.
Wow, quick. Dark City.
In Bruges.
Wow. Strange choices. Yeah. All right, here it is. All for the marbles. Your first, Dark City. You have to pick a movie. Mm-hmm. Watch this movie 4 mm-hmm. times in 1 day. Dark City, GT, time begins when you begin speaking.
If you're going to watch a film 4 times in 1 day, you want to find something different every time you watch it. Alex Proyas made that film in almost every level. You can find something new when it comes to set design, the world building, cinematography, the acting, the way the puzzle comes together. And not only to mention, Roger Ebert has one of the best audio commentaries he's ever done, which is could also be used for the third time. So when you watch it the third time with the Ebert commentary, you pick up so much more in the fourth.
Coy.
In Bruges' writing is so tight and so prolific and so important that every time you watch it, you get a different characterization of each character. It also ends in a way that you feel different about the narrative going through it. So when you rewatch it that second time, you have a different perspective. The third time, another and another. Every supporting character in that film gets their own arc. So each viewing, you can focus on a different character. And the writing is so important and so funny that you often laughed over the last joke. It is a movie that requires rewatchability to enjoy fully. So rewatching it in 1 day is not a problem.
JT, final 10 seconds.
Bruges is a well-written movie, but every time I watch it, I feel like I got exactly what I got from the time before. There's nothing as far as levels. There's nothing that much deeper. The characters are so well-written that I get everything out of it the first time. Dark City is literally a puzzle that needs to be solved by rewatching.
10 seconds.
Dark City's been remade because it was so prolific so many times that I've seen it 4 times in a day, and I don't think that movie needs to be reviewed. It is a movie that has pacing, and in Bruges is a much more entertaining film. I want to be entertained when I go back through it. Dark City doesn't entertain the second time.
All right.
Give me another 10.
Casey, geez. Connor, what do you think on the couch based on the arguments? God. Quickly.
So I've seen neither of these movies. So I have complete clean
completely
slate.
I'm biased.
JTE just kind of gave me more reasons why I think he killed the argument.
How?
Yeah, I've seen both of these movies, not 4 times in 1 day. Mm-hmm. But JTE, I felt he cinched it in at the end.
The commentary track was Ebert. A genius
one of the
play.
Only Ebert
that
wrote.
Technically counts. Ebert is watching them again. Done.
Yeah.
That was a stroke of genius in my mind. That overstood Coy very strong and close, but I got to give it to JT as well. JT gets a seat.
Thank you.
In the championship refight. Congratulations. Big tech take down the master of
yeah. Coy, great damn job,
JT,
though.
You did
thanks, sir. Thank you. Thank
wow.
You.
Dude.
Dark City.
That was close. That was
two weird movies we went with.
Yeah.
Very weird movies. But that, you guys did it. And congratulations, Coy Jandrew at Coy Jandrew on Twitter. What a bravo job. Good kudos job, to man. You. Anything you'd like to plug?
I just did an awesome Does It Hold Up Here about Never Ending Story that was so much fun, so that's going to drop soon. And I do Marvel Movie News, which we do every week on Tuesday, and I love, if you can't tell, Marvel very much, and DC's doing a great job catching up, so you can find me there every week on Tuesdays at Popcorn Talk.
What a positive way to throw DC some shade.
they're doing just well.
JT Movie Things.
Yeah, catch me on YouTube, JT Movie Things. I do movie reviews, trailer reactions, whatever my geeky mind wants to talk about. I just love going on there and talking movies with people. This was these are two guys, if you asked me if I could fight anybody besides Dan for the belt, these are two guys I would want to fight because I just love Hal and Coy. It's kind of like when Sugar Ray Leonard watched Marvin Hagler fight and he literally got up at the end of the fight and said, I think I could beat him.
Dude, I've heard this for months.
And I seen Coy and I'm like, I think I could beat him. It wouldn't be easy, But I felt like I had a chance. But man, you brought me to the limit.
He brings it. Hal, and you brought it as well. Kudos to you. You've been fantastic on a streak. Hal Rudnick on Twitter. What else would you like to throw out
there? Yeah, I just want to say that watching, there were several moments throughout this this argument where this game, and where like you guys said things that made my heart drop a little bit, because it's like, damn, you, good points. Like, huge movie fans and like passionate arguing. And man, it's like mad respect for both you guys. And our new Screen Junkies show dropped today, and we talked to an actual doctor of an actual therapist who is a PhD who helps us break down the psychology of Disney princesses and the mental conditions that they experience.
Does Belle have Stockholm syndrome?
Does Belle have Stockholm syndrome? Yep.
It's a great episode.
And then we also talk about Little Mermaid, Pinocchio, all sorts of stuff.
Yes, it's a really good work on that, Hal. And Dan Merle on the couch. Now, how you feeling, GT? You made it through.
This was I knew this would be a great fight. They didn't disappoint me. There are no losers in this fight, except for Coy and Hal. I'm joking. No, this is great. This is so much fun. And so, yeah, we have now Mance and JTE, and then do we want to announce the third seat?
The third seat will be done through a viewer's choice fight.
Viewers will pick three fighters.
We are currently lining up the schedules of several fighters who will be available to fight and then come back for the finale.
Dang.
You at home will be able to take that vote, so stay along on Twitter and stuff so we can follow you, so you can follow and learn when to vote will happen. But yes, you guys will be deciding who sits in that third seat, or who sits in those three seats to battle it out in the next viewers' vote fight. So get excited for that. The winner of that fight will then fill the third seat, and then those three people will fight. The winner of that person will take on Dan Merle.
One-on-one. Exactly. I love doing this one-on-one. I wanted to do the belt fight one-on-one. It's so much fun. Just mano a mano.
I like it.
Wow.
I don't know. I fought Matt Land this one-on-one, that was so much fun, and I don't know.
So
like
get excited, and next week is our Collider Last Fighter Standing. The whole gang is coming over. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be chaos, so stay tuned for next week's show. And I want to thank our fans. Casey, Connor, thank you guys so much for coming. Your birthday cake looked incredible. Cookie dough middle.
Oh my gosh.
It looked insane. I'm so sad you didn't bring it.
So great.
Cookie dough middle.
You'll have to send one. But honestly,
the turducken of cakes.
Yeah, great. But thank you guys for coming. Did you have fun?
Oh, we had a great time. Thank you so much for having us.
And I'll make sure you guys go get to say that to Joe Starr in person. Anyone who wants to do that, just come talk to me. I'll arrange it. No, we love Joe. But thank you both, and thank you all. We will try and do a quick after the fight, very quick one right after this. So stay tuned, and you can watch us on Plus. Thank you so much. Have a great weekend, and have a good one. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.